Hi, and welcome to 1 in 20 D&D. I'm Gregory. Thanks for stopping by today. I'm really excited about this video because this is the introduction for the first episode of the first campaign we're going to be putting up here on this channel. And it is a Out of the Abyss campaign. So hopefully you are familiar with Out of the Abyss. It's a fantastic campaign written by the folks over at Wizards of the Coast and Dungeons&Dragons. It's a 5th edition campaign, of course. I will put some information in the links below, or the information below. And the funny thing about this is that I just finished reading the Dark Elf Trilogy by R.A. Salvatore. Fantastic books. If you haven't read them, there's three books. This is just the compendium of all three. And they're fantastic and wonderful series to read about, of course, Driz Doerden, the most famous Dark Elf there is. So to be adventuring in the Underdark is super exciting to me, and I'm really looking forward to it. So here we go. This is our first episode. We had a lot of fun. I'm actually not running the game. I'm a player in this game. I'm having a lot of fun as a player in the game, so hopefully you'll enjoy, and here we go. Now, there's two things I want to mention real quick. First and foremost, we do use a little bit of adult language. We're adults, so hey, you know, what can you expect? Sometimes it happens. And more importantly, these first couple videos are actually going to be more like a podcast style. It's going to be just our audio from the game, and I do have some screenshots to kind of post up some of the pictures of maps and a little bit of what was happening throughout the campaign. However, in the future, we're going to move towards actually streaming it, so that'll be a little more dynamic and hopefully more interesting for all of you. So, here you go. Let's get started and see what happens in our first episode, episode 1 of Out of the Abyss. Let's see what happens. Oh my goodness, I almost forgot to do the quick character backgrounds, and I'm going to do a very quick character background, and we'll do a nice full-out character background in the future. So the quick rundown is this. I will be playing a half-orc fighter cleric named Brill, and there we have Michelle playing Kyramiel Nilo, the drow druid, also called Kyra. Reed will be playing Farron Day, our half-elven sorcerer, and John is playing Raven Oakbow, our elven ranger. Alright, so that's just a quick rundown of the characters. You'll get a little more introduction here as we get started, and we'll do a nice background of each character coming up. So stay tuned for that, but hey, in the meantime, let's get rolling.
So, all right. Brill is a... Do you want to, let's see, we're not actually meeting each other at this moment, right? We're just doing...
No. This is just like, give me a scene in what you happen to be doing, like, right now. Like, you're traveling, and you're along the road, blah, 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 whatever.
Yeah, so Brill left his, the town where he kind of cut his teeth, and pretty much left with nothing. He had a table leg he was using as a club, and the rags that he wore because of his kind of slightly tragic backstory. He was an orphan on the streets, and a kind city guard captain took him under wing, and eventually the guard captain was promoted and became captain of the guard. I mean, he was a lieutenant at one point. They first met. He was eventually promoted to captain of the guard, but then he was killed in a scuffle in town, unfortunately. So Brill kind of decided he would go out, make a name for himself, and eventually become a captain of the guard himself. So he did that, and at the moment he has been traveling with some small degree of success. He has found his way to following Torm as a patron and liege and deity, and he is currently out to smite evil.
Can you be a little more specific than out to smite evil? Like, it doesn't have to be super, just like, like, I don't know. Paint
he's a superhero.
Like, kick evil's butt.
That's right.
But no, I mean, like,
justice.
like that's like a big picture thing of like out to smite evil and like adventuring and stuff. I mean, like, very specifically, like.
Specifically,
like you were
on,
you in a town and you, like, you know.
Like, the game is beginning now, right? Like, I'm asking, like, what is this, like, the day to day experience of Brill present day right now?
He's pretty much sleeping on the road, like sleeping on his own. It's kind of probably dangerous, but that's the way he is, so to speak.
Like just camping out under a tree or something?
Exactly.
All right, perfect. So, it's just a typical day in your adventuring life. Kind of boring, kind of quiet. You've been traveling for most of the day. It's almost dark, and you're kind of getting the feeling like, you know, it's about time to set up camp. It's not quite dark yet. Like, the sun is still setting. You've got maybe a couple hours, like an hour to like half an hour before it totally sets. You're not really near any inns. You're still a little ways off. If you traveled all through the night, you could probably make it. What would you like to do?
Well, I can see maybe the city of Waterdeep off in the distance, and
yeah.
I'm probably still a little trepidatious, you know, about entering such a huge city. And just find either a rock outcropping or a nice, you know, oak or large tree that I can shelter under.
Yeah, you spend some time searching and you find a pretty comfy-looking tree to lie under. You get your bedroll out, you make a little camp, you get out some light travel rations for some dinner. Your typical routine.
Kind of roll everything up into my cloak and then... And basically, I'm like sleep sitting again with my back against the tree.
Could you roll a perception for me?
Indeed. I'm gonna use the tokens for the buttons for now. We'll see how it goes.
Sure.
Pathetic. 9.
I don't know if this is gonna whisper. It didn't whisper. Great.
Okay. I think you need a space.
Get the space. Yeah.
Also, the slash is on the wrong side of the W.
Oh, is it? Okay. Okay.
I think that's. Yeah.
Okay. Wasn't sure. There we go. Slash was on the wrong side. All right.
So you rolled a 9, yes?
Yeah, I'm kind of sleepy tonight, I guess.
The 9 might be good enough. Actually, it's not good enough. No, you're just kind of sleepy. You're getting ready to close your eyes, and you know you're getting comfy in bed. Roll ahead another perception.
10.
Yeah, not good enough, man. Oh, geez, this is actually real sad, but it'll also keep the suspense going a little bit longer for everyone else, I think.
It's all good.
Yeah, this is real anticlimactic, I'm sorry to say. You close your eyes, and you go to sleep, and that's all you remember for now. I guess we'll get back to Brill.
That's all you remember for now.
I guess we'll get back to Brill. Wow, that kind of backfired. Who would like to go next?
Dice. Real dice.
unless Farron wants to go, then I'll go.
I don't mind. You guys can care.
Alright. This is... In my mind, this is what's happening. Kyra and a Raven are in a town. There's, you know, people kind of, you know, walking around on the streets or whatever. Kyra has her hood up. She has gloves on. She doesn't want people to know that she's a dark elf. And, you know, Raven is kind of at her feet right now trying to fix her boot. And there's like this little kid. Just hear me out. There's this little kid and with like his mom walking by. And Kyra says, hey, Raven, did you want to ride me like you did yesterday? And then the mother's like closing her son's ears. Oh! And like, you know, and then we're looking like, no, that's not okay. And, you know, because she can turn into a horse and it just makes travel very easy.
Right.
Kind of thing. And it's like, oh, never mind.
All right.
That's like I imagine where we're at, but where we are and what we're doing.
That's a perfect beginning. You said you're in a town. I'm imagining kind of like a smallish.
I don't know. That's Raven's thing. I'm going to go with whatever he says, but that's what happened at that moment.
I'm also going with whatever he says because this is your characters. And...
All right. Yeah, because the whole Evermate story was completely true, much like this one.
Yep.
So what I'm currently doing is I'm always actively trying to find, especially if it's, I'm assuming it's near evening, like Brill's situation.
Yeah.
I'm always looking for a place. I'm very, I guess, to kind of sum up my character's background, I'm very anti-bully, very much kind of the Robin Hood for the little guy. Not to steal and from the rich and give to the poor, but to make right for the people who don't have a voice for themselves, per se. So in that, I'm always in the defensive mindset of what's best for Kira. Where can she at least rest for an evening to stay somewhat protected and out of the light of, you know, being ostracized for who she is. And typically when we're out in the, I guess, the wilds, I would always be finding the best defensible position that I can being in town. I certainly want an elevated position being the archer that I am. If we can find a cheap, maybe we could sneak into a barn, sleep above a barn, or just find a rooftop, and if there's a flat roof, camp out up there, if that's possible without getting caught.
And Kyra totally agrees, but in her mind she's like, I miss my comfortable bed that I had. And as I said before, Raven is the only... She told Raven the truth, because we had been traveling together for a long time. And so she's kind of shy, a fairly private person, but she's like, you know, basically sworn him to secrecy kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And but he knows, and so... And not like I make him apologize for us sleeping in these areas, and I don't outwardly complain, but in my head I'm thinking, oh hell, we got to stay in another one of these again.
But I guess also in my mind, I'm kind of bored with our current situation. I feel like we can be doing more. There's something. I feel like there's something on the horizon that is calling to me, but I can't quite put my finger on it.
Yeah, well, I'm just following him. I really don't know what I'm doing.
That's an accurate description of your future, I guess. The tallest building in town would be the kind of bell tower to the chapel. It's kind of towers above the other buildings, which are mostly, you know, two or three stories at most. Probably not the most comfortable place to sleep, but definitely the most defensible.
And it wakes you up. If somebody rings the bell at 7 alarm.
Yeah. But someone would have to go up there and see you guys. And then.
Okay.
But you're pretty sure you're not supposed to be sleeping in bell towers anyway.
All right.
But, you know, I'm sure this is kind of a regular thing for you guys, sleeping where you're not necessarily allowed to be sleeping.
I'm not as familiar with the 5e edition of Forgotten Realms. I mean, our drow that might be not traditional drow, like, third edition drow, second edition drow, be walking around? Is this more common now?
Not super common, no.
Okay.
Yeah. People know who Drizzt is, but...
Yeah.
Still.
He is very much the exception that proves the rule, though.
Anomaly.
I really don't enforce in my games any kind of, like, drow are always evil and must be evil always because they're drow and that's how they are. But, like, overwhelmingly speaking, like, there are a couple of exceptions. But most drow are kind of assholes.
Just right. Which is why she keeps her, you know, her hood down, try to not ruffle too many feathers, you know, kind of do the whole try to not be so seen, and really lets Raven do a lot of the talking kind of thing.
So like that saying, you know, a few bad apples spoil the bunch, but in the case of the drought, there's lots of bad apples.
It's mostly bad apples, yeah. But would you guys be staying in the bell tower then?
If she's okay with that.
I'm cool. I've learned over the, you know, the almost year that we've been traveling together that, you know, he's trustworthy, he knows what he's doing, you know, he's a ranger, he's got it. I just kind of say, okay, no biggie.
Can you guys, I'm assuming you're trying to, like, climb up the side of the chapel,
rather than like,
going inside and, you know, saying hi to all the priests and monks.
Yeah, probably not.
Your assassins creep up the side of the tower.
Yeah, basically. Can you guys both roll me athletics and stealth?
Yeah, I want to roll my dice, so I'm going to just turn on my little camera.
Athletics and which one? Stealth?
Stealth.
Ooh, that's pretty good, huh? I can see that. All right. Okay. So I guess we'll do...
Damn.
Stealth.
Those are some rolls.
Looks like damn like you wanted me to fail.
No. Like, No. I'm not an antagonistic DM. I'm happy to see players succeed.
Aw. Stealth is missing on here. Alright, well, then I'll just look it up myself. Dex. +2. Alright. So, can y'all... Oh, no, you can't see that. You can't see that. Ooh, and I have a yellow die, so you really can't see that, huh?
It's like a 3. It's a 5.
It's a 5. Okay, so 5 + 2. 7 stealth.
I think Raven rolled well enough for you to, like, make up for it.
Okay. Ooh, natural 20!
For the climbing?
Yeah,
the athletics? For the climbing. Yeah, okay. You guys make it up, no problem. There are a couple kind of moments you have to kind of stop and not move while they're, you know, people are passing by and need on their way home or what have you, on the way to the pub for last call. But eventually you manage to climb all the way up and get settled and get comfy. The sun is now setting at this point. You guys just gonna go straight to bed?
Yeah, I mean, I'll keep an eye on unsuspecting people. Just kind of get the flow. Just watch people for a while. It's kind of my thing. Just
maybe we'll take turns eventually to where he can get an actual full night's rest, I imagine.
Take turns meditating?
Yeah, right. I meditate for, you know, 4 hours.
You guys only meditate 4 hours, that's true.
Yeah, take turns meditating. Not really sleeping.
Yeah, so I guess if you guys are sleeping in shifts, then at least one of you is going to be awake at any given point, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Who has Raven? You have first watch?
Sure, I'll take first watch.
Okay. It's kind of a boring first watch. I mean, you're just kind of at the highest point of this very sleepy village, and you're, you know, seeing the occasional person milling around. As the night kind of drags on, that stops. Totally dark. There's just the occasional, you know, light out in the street for some major intersections, but there's no one out at this point. All the pubs are closed, all the inns are closed, everything's closed. And just as your watch is about to end, and Gerard is about to start, you think you notice something in the distance. You're not sure. It could be boredom. It could be, you know, your eyes playing tricks on you, but you're pretty good at this, so you're not sure. But you, yeah, roll me perception is what I'm trying to get at.
Yay!
Y'all can... I'm sorry. Y'all can see the brown one the best, even though I absolutely love my yellow dye. Can you see that one the best? I'm not really sure.
I can... Yeah, the one closest to the camera is the one I can see the best.
Okay, yeah. All right.
The other two in the middle are kind of like see-through in that.
Yeah. Little... They're my best dyes. They roll... Well, either they roll awesome or they roll crap. Like... So I usually roll it because it's like 20 and 1, 20 and 1. But you know, I love it. But I'll roll the brown one.
You can roll any dice you want. As long as it's like, I don't know. And even honestly, even if you don't have the webcam on it, I trust you not to cheat yourself.
I would hope so, but I'll do it anyways, just cause you get to know me, and then you can like say, yeah, she's trustworthy. No. I'm just gonna do it. Just because you would appreciate it if we did it on here, and I will do my like spells on here on the computer.
That'd probably be best. I mean, if like
I'll do my spells on the computer.
You have to roll like 8d6 or something.
Yeah, yeah, no. Yeah, I'll do it on the computer.
But with a 9 perception, you're really not sure if you saw something or if it was just the wind. You're kind of a highway up and a ways off. This is something at the edge of town, so you're not sure. You don't really take any actions, I'm assuming.
No, I mean, I'd probably just pass it off as something, just kind of whatever.
A couple minutes later, it seems like there might have actually been something there, because you start to hear the sounds of battle and screaming.
Oh, wow.
Streets.
Okay. Wow.
You are an elf. You have dark vision out to 60 feet. And
I have 120.
Yeah, Kira's is even better. Actually notice some drow out in the street.
Oh my.
They are kind of moving in force. They seem to just be attacking people at random. Some they're just slaughtering on the spot. Some they're kind of kidnapping and taking away. And they've, as far as you can tell, they have the town encircled.
Oh my!
And are moving through kind of systematically through the streets.
Well, I guess is Kira even awake yet at this point?
That's up to her.
I don't know. Like, I mean, I'm sleeping. You probably would just, you know, kick me in the leg and probably wake up, especially if they're screaming. But, you know, I was thinking because of how I try to be all stealthy and stuff, like, I probably just had a hard time being subconscious. And it's just like, yes, I'm finally here. I can go to sleep and then just knock out. So unless you're waking me up, I'm out.
I'm waking you up, especially when I see that they're drow. I don't really understand your race, and it's, of course, never not anything personal.
As if
it's
I just... do. Yeah. Yeah, I pretty much don't understand my own race either. But, yeah. Cool beans. So, yeah, I wake up.
Well, you're awake. You see the same thing that Raven does, if not a little better, with your better vision.
How many?
It's hard to say, but like less than 50.
Oh crap!
You can see, but again, like it looks like they have the town encircled, so there might be some at the edge that you can't see.
Okay, so I say to Raven, I say,
it's a small army.
I say, Raven, you know my history and all, but my mother told me that most are bad. So, that's all I know. And, all right. I was like left outside of a cave. So I don't, I mean, I don't know. Like, I was raised by wood elves. You know, you're a wood elf.
Your mother told you most are bad. This is where we had that conversation about, yeah, all of us on this surface level are all taught that most of you are bad. So.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay.
So my point right now is I'm not so concerned about the city. I think the guard might have enough guards here. I can do what I can from up here. But the point is, if we survive this day and you're still in this town, we got issues.
Oh,
or you got issues. Oh, because
I'm a drow. Okay.
Correct. So we not only need to survive this evening, we need to get out of here.
Yeah, maybe while the commotion's going, then let's slip out.
Kind of going back to something Raven said, it doesn't really seem like the city has that many guards. There's maybe a small militia. This is kind of somewhere between a town and a village.
Wow, so they are just...
It is just a massacre. Total surprise.
Jeez, yeah,
and they're beginning to set fire to buildings, also.
Crap. Yeah, I'm looking at, very much looking at Raven, what should we do? I think maybe we should go, but I'm looking at him for confirmation. You're the leader. I'm just gonna do what you're gonna do.
Is there I'm picturing an old style church type thing with the steeple in the front, uh-huh, and we're kind of up in the bell tower, and then there's a pitched roof off the back.
Yes, yes, yes. That's okay.
So
what I was picturing as well.
If we could climb down to the top of that pitch and make our way down that, and then off the back. Is there much village or town on the backside of the church, or is it just kind of...
The church is kind of in the center. I mean, that's kind of part of the reason
it was a
nice place to be. It was nice and central, and it had a very high vantage point where you could see the entire city around you, which seemed like a really good idea at the time, I'm sure.
Is there you know how people have storm shelters and stuff like that? Is there any kind of thing like that?
Like a basement?
Yeah, like a basement or a storm shelter.
You could search for one. That would
maybe
be
either near the church or, you know, some place where we're not running out hey, look at us.
There's no basement access on the roof, but
I figured once we climb down the way that he suggested.
You could roll an investigation and see if you spot one.
Alright.
I'm assuming also that you guys don't want to be spotted as you're climbing down.
Yes, correct.
So, yes.
That would entail more stealth rolls.
Okay. All right. Well, stealth first. I got 8 plus 2. That'd be 10. Oh, you can't see that one. Boop. 10. We are so ultra stealthy. we are so stealthed. All right.
Well, it kind of plays into the reality of it, though. I mean, we are trying to hurry as best as we can.
That's true.
I need to wake up.
Yeah. I look amazingly beautiful when I wake up. No crust in the eyes, no drool on the mouth.
Just silver hair flowing behind
That's
you.
That's right. That's what it is, just like the movies. Okay, investigation.
Yes.
Ooh, 18 plus nice. 1, 19.
Did Raven roll stealth?
I did. I rolled 12.
Oh, you did. You did roll 12. Okay. I'm sorry. Ultra stealthy. I didn't see that. Okay. And you rolled a 19, you said, on MSC?
I sure did. Can you see my 18?
I see the 18, and I'm assuming it's a plus 1?
Yes.
Yeah, actually, you're, I guess, as luck would have it, you kind of fall down. You come down on the correct side of the church to kind of see the almost flat into the ground doors, kind of slanted very slightly to lead into the basement. It's right nearby. You guys could run into the basement if you'd like, but I'm pretty sure. You're pretty sure, rather. I mean, I know, but you strongly suspect that one of the drow may have seen you.
Crap. I look at Raven. I point it out. I say, we can go over there. Maybe we can hide. But
you look at Raven and you say something out loud, or you make some hand gestures or something?
No.
Or?
Yeah, I'm doing the whole... Okay.
Raven, roll stealth again.
Yeah, I'm doing the whole, here's a hand, and... over there.
Oh man, this just gets better and better.
So I don't like say it, but I'm all like, you know, doing a, I'm pretty sure I'm gesturing very loudly.
Yeah.
Even though I'm quiet.
Yeah. They hadn't seen Raven before, but now that they see you kind of gesturing and communicating with someone, they kind of look around and, oh, there's another one.
Please tell me it's, like, really dark at night and I haven't washed my face in months.
It is really dark at night. It's like 3 a.m. at this point. If you haven't washed your face in months, that's true for you. I'm not going to tell you how often your characters bathe.
All right.
I try to whenever I can.
But the drow do have, they're elves, so they... Actually, you this isn't revealing anything. You have a drow in the party. You know they have... dark vision. So,
superior.
Do I notice them looking at us, concentrating on trying to tell?
Your way,
hey, Raven, there is a. Okay.
There's kind of a group of four of them, specifically, that were kind of tearing through the streets and then setting fire to the building next to the chapel. Who have noticed you and are now kind of approaching you.
Run?
I pull Reed's character out of my handy haversack.
My Minotaur character.
I can't group charm. I can only
told
charm
you we
one of them.
That meteor swarm scroll.
Oh, can I like so thunder wave them and then we try to run? Can I so do that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They are kind of grouped up.
How close are they from us?
Like 60 feet enclosed.
Oh yeah, I want to like. Let's see. Oh, sorry, can't do that yet. Oh, try look. I need to see. All right. Alright, so let's see, 15-foot cube. I wanna kind of do one of those let me run a little bit close to them within like that whole bubble, like I'm like doing one of those hi, I'm just like you Thunderwave kind of thing.
Oh, so you're gonna like pull back your hood and reveal that you're a drow and
yeah. And then do like Thunderwave and then be like turn around and take off running kind of thing.
Okay,
like
yeah.
Grab like Raven's hand and be like, let's go or whatever.
Yeah. I hope it works.
Yeah,
go for it.
I hope it does too. That's all I can think of at the moment. Since they're all grouped together in a nice space. And I hope I didn't just F up the whole thing just to say that. Raven, but yeah. All right. Click on a token on the screen. Well, I can't.
There should be a drow token.
Oh yeah, I can do that. Ha ha! I can do that.
Ha 13 DC saving throw to save from being pushed away. Let's see if.
And
they...
it's half damage if they're not pushed.
Damage.
So they'll take half damage if they're not pushed away. But I'm hoping they're pushed. Let them be pushed.
Let's find out. No.
Oh, crap.
No, they're not.
I tried!
So you kind of... I don't know if you guys would know this, but it's fine. So drow warriors can be either male or female, but generally in drow society, females are kind of... considered higher up. All the priestesses are female. They kind of run drow society. So at first the drows are approaching and they've got their crossbows drawn and aimed. And then, you know, Kyra pulls her hood back and, you know, her hair unfurls and, oh, she's one of us and she's a female. And they're kind of unsure what to do for a minute.
And I totally hepped it up.
And you're just walking closer and closer until you're in range. And then you kind of like rub your hands together, and you kind of hear the distant like rumble of thunder, and then you just clap them together and make a big loud type of sound. And you've done this before. Nice. And you know, normally
I actually just look out the window thinking a storm is coming. I'm not kidding. I'm still, like, hell for that one.
And you've done this before, and normally, you know, you can knock your enemies on their ass, you know, knock them back 10, 15 feet, give yourself quite a bit of breathing room. These guys are barely phased. Like, you can see their hair kind of ruffle behind them.
Sorry! I didn't know who you were! Just grab Raven's hand and run, if I can.
And well, instantly, like, as soon as, like, their hair, like, settles back into place, like, as soon as the spell kind of fades... well, they do take 4 damage, for what it's worth, all of them. They just... There's no more, like, confusion. There's no more, like, cautiously approaching to see who these strangers are. They're just attacking.
Yeah, I'm an idiot, well, you know?
No. I mean, you tried something, it
My
worked.
Intelligence is not too great.
two of them fire on you, Kira.
I'm panicking at this moment.
Wait, hold on. Why is... Oh, no, hold on. Forget that happened. Why?
Whoa.
I think something weird happened. Oh, no. What a disaster. What's your AC?
Oh, my AC, well, I have my equipment with me, so yes, therefore it is a 15. 15.
Why is it... Oh, man, this is so embarrassing. Like, the first actual roll, and it turns out the character sheet's messed up.
It happens a lot.
We found that it happens on some of them.
Yeah, which is... That was my reason for liking to roll by hand, because of that.
Let me actually try that again. I might have just fixed it. I feel like whenever I copied over the old campaign that I had, like, some of the things didn't copy over, and some of them did, like some settings, mostly.
Yep.
Did that work? Yeah, okay, yes, so now there's an actual, like, attack against your AC. Anyway, back to the game. Two of the 4 drow fire on you, Kira. The other two...
Take one Haven. Hit, one miss.
One hit, one miss. Oh, that's a crit.
Oh, no!
And that's a hit.
Oh, it's a soft crit.
Kira, you're hit once. You take 6 piercing damage, and also, can you roll me a constitution save?
Oh, okay. Alright, I'm gonna roll on here. Constitution. Oh, that wasn't good. That wasn't good.
No.
7.
That's not good. No.
7.
You actually did fail by 5 or more. You actually fall unconscious. Like you feel the drow poison kind of like coursing through your veins and kind of expanding from the spot you were hit on your leg. It kind of courses up through your body and through your arms, and when it reaches your head, you can kind of see your vision swimming, getting more and more blurry and watery, and you kind of have trouble maintaining your balance. And this happens in the span of, you know, a couple seconds, up to 10 seconds.
I try.
And then you are just...
I say that before I fall.
conveniently, the way you kind of fall, you have your last gaze on Raven as he's hit by 2 bolts.
Okay.
How much HP do you have?
Me?
Yeah.
18.
Pretty
much wipes it out.
You also fall unconscious.
Pretty much, but not entirely, right? Like,
pretty sexy 20. When I fall on the ground. Just saying.
24.
Is that 24? It is 24. My bad. Yeah, you are... you can also make constitution saves against falling unconscious, but... You're falling unconscious either way. And that's all you guys remember.
Right, okay.
Oh my god.
I guess all that's left to do is
thanks.
Is Reed.
Yeah.
Isn't that Farron?
Alrighty then, here we go.
Oh, you're saying 6?
So you want me to explain what I've been doing?
Yeah. Just,
Yep. So I imagine that I've been in some kind of town looking for research or some kind of evidence. I've probably been poring through tomes if I'm in a town that has a library or something like that. It's probably getting late in the night, so
hold
I'm
on.
Just like, you know, done for the day. I'm going to head to the tavern sort of thing. It seems like charm my way into getting a free meal and a bed sort of thing.
So you're just kind of walking the streets?
Yeah. It's probably like, you know, afternoon-ish, like late afternoon.
Late afternoon?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You know, like finishing off some reading and some, you know, like poring through some old tomes and things like that. And yeah. Gonna see if I can find somewhere to stay tonight.
Well, late afternoon is kind of a sleepy time in the town you're in. There's nothing really exciting going on. People are, you know, some people are still at work, some people are kind of in the same boat you're in, heading out to the tavern. Not much going on. Sun is still high in the sky if it's late afternoon, so got plenty of time. It's totally bright, totally safe. You make it to your tavern with no complications whatsoever.
Well, this has happened before where I've gone and tried to flirt my way in to getting a free room and food, and it hasn't worked sometimes, so I don't like to leave it too late, because then I'm sneaking around trying to steal something like middle of the night, and I don't really want to do that.
Makes sense.
I got work to do in the morning.
So you're just kind of sitting in this tavern trying to charm your way into a free room? How specifically are you going about doing that?
If there's like a barmaid, I'll probably just try and flirt a bit, see if I can get like a free meal or something like that.
Try and bunk with her, as it were.
Oh, no, not so much. More like
That's a free room, right?
Well, I mean, if they like, I won't do anything because I'm not that kind of person. Because that's, you know, that's kind of part of his backstory. But if he was, he'd probably like sleep on the floor. But if he could get a room to himself, that'd be great, or just something to eat in a room.
Yeah, roll me a... what do I want you to roll me? Wouldn't necessarily be persuasion. Or would it?
Yeah. Why not?
Yeah, sure, let's make it a persuasion. I was kind of wavering between persuasion or just a general charisma check.
Okay. Oh, well, then that's just totally up to you.
Alright, so I'll roll this one. It's a bit far away from the camera, to tell you, so I'll just do it. Yeah, that's a 2. 11.
Yeah, just luck doesn't seem to be on your side tonight. The barmaids are all very suspicious, and when they approach and, you know, you lay on your honeyed words, they just, all you...
I left it a bit late, so I'm just like, oh, yeah, he gone there.
The best you're getting is kind of a raised eyebrow and
okay.
You know, like, what, you can't pay for
me? I've had this before. Alrighty then, so I'm kind of like, okay, never mind, it's all good. You know, have a lovely day, or evening, as it were, sort of thing. So I'm just like, so I'm sitting there again, okay, plan B it is then. would I have seen any, like, jerks in town?
Like, that I remember?
Yeah, I kind of like keep a log of any like jerks.
Just asshole.
Pretty much, yeah.
You spent most of the day in the library. Characters.
I don't like to steal from nice people, you know. But people who have it coming, yeah, sure.
I mean, you just spent most of your day in the library, and you didn't really like meet or anyone notable on the way to the tavern.
Okay.
I mean, there were a couple of like. Not necessarily, you know, jerks, but just, like, drunk people in the tavern with you.
Yeah.
Who were, like, maybe less than optimally polite, but calling them a jerk is kind of a stretch.
Yeah. Drunk people are usually a bit... Alrighty then, well... I'll get up and leave, because apparently I can't stay here.
you can stay there, but you're kind of the... I'm trying to think of a polite metaphor for it, but like, you're there, but you can't do anything. You can't buy a room or buy a drink, so you're just kind of the guy in a bar who isn't drinking because he can't afford a drink.
Yeah. Oh, that's fine. I don't mind that, but I'm a bit hungry. I'm going to eat that way.
Yeah.
Any money. So, all right, well, I will... Yeah, I'll see if I can head outside and see if I can find somewhere that maybe looks a little, you know, that might have some money that I can maybe borrow.
Sure. You spent maybe an hour or two at most trying to chat up this barmaid.
Yeah.
So it's maybe like 6 p.m. now. Sun is still out. You still have a couple of hours of sunlight to go. You look around. Actually, roll me a investigation.
Investigation? Okay. That is a plus 3. A 5. So 5 plus 3.
Maybe this town just doesn't have any marks that you're looking for. Anyone that kind of fits your description. Or maybe you're just looking in all the wrong places, in the wrong part of town. But you don't seem to... Like, most of the people you see just look very plain. You don't see any kind of exposed purses or anything. You see, you know, like a couple of, you know, could be beggars or homeless type people.
Yeah.
But really just nothing.
All right, plan C then it is. Can I sneak into the back? Is there a back door to the tavern? Like, hopefully, in, like, into the kitchen, maybe?
There's a back door to the...
Cool. Can I sneak in the back door?
Roll me a stealth.
This is funny.
I'm not going to roll that dice.
It's treated you so well thus far.
Oh, a 15. That's good. 15 plus 7.
15 plus 7, okay. You crack open the kitchen door. There's two or three humans just kind of, you know, chopping onions, and, you know, one's tending a spit with a roast on it, and they're all just kind of very dutifully minding their duties.
Yep.
They seem to be very busy. They seem to be kind of understaffed for the demand of food.
Okay.
They're working very quickly, hurrying back and forth, and no one seems to notice you at all.
Do I see any, like, bread, like, on a bench or something like that? Anything? Like, is there anything, like, close to me that I could quickly, like, just jump out the back?
I'm tempted to say no, but I want to let you roll for it.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of what you would roll.
Investigation.
Maybe investigation? How about just sleight of hand? Just roll a sleight of hand and we'll see how.
Steals
sleight of hand. It's a plus 5. And I rolled a 15 again.
Nice!
15 plus 5. 10, 20.
Yeah, there really isn't anything near you.
Yeah.
But you're able to kind of, like, almost... I'm trying to think of the video game that I'm trying to think of, but I can't remember what it is. But it's almost like... video game levels of comical, how, like, these kitchen workers just don't seem to notice you at all, and you're, like, sneaking up, you're directly behind them, like, leaning left and right as they're leaning left.
Like, I'll duck behind, like, a sack of flour or something.
I mean, it's...
Do a roll behind one of them.
And like, as soon as, like, they look left to the stew, you'll, like, grab a bread from the right, and they look right to the bread, and you'll, like, reach to the left and grab an onion or something. And they're just almost so busy they don't even notice.
Nice.
It takes a lot of doing, and it's not easy at all, but you do manage.
Yeah. Cool. All right, I'll just get what I can, basically, like, you know, a bit of bread, a bit of onion, whatever I can get, and I'll just, like, roll back out the door and then quietly shut the door.
You can go ahead and add bread and onion to your inventory if you like.
Nice. Well, I'm guessing I'm going to be eating.
Yeah, I mean, so. If you're going to be eating it, then yeah.
Yeah.
Probably no point.
Bread and onion sandwich.
Mm-hmm. Yummy.
It's just a loaf of bread. Pretty decent, but plain white bread, and then just one whole head of an onion. Is what you
okay.
got.
Nice. All right, cool. I will... usually whenever I come into a town, I look for some place before I'll walk around the town to get to know the place, and then I'll find the place, like the library or some kind of like place where I can maybe find something to study. But while I'm doing that, I'll look for places where I could maybe sleep, just in case I can't get a room.
Yeah, so like for these plan C type of situations.
Yeah.
So if you've done that in advance, I'm just gonna, let's just say you found one. What did you find?
Cool. Probably I would say maybe on the outskirts of town, not outskirts, but like on the, probably like maybe on the farm side of town if there is one.
Yeah,
maybe
yeah.
Like
under a tree or in the fields or something.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Or like maybe in a barn.
Like a barn or something like that, or like some kind of, you know, hay bale and kind of pig style or something. I don't know.
Yeah, just something of... Okay, I got you.
Yeah, somewhere I'll be able to be comfortable.
Well, you head back out to the kind of more rural parts of town.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of the buildings get more and more sparse as you,
yeah.
as you travel. And right along the edge, you did see a barn that you had kind of... remembered. That's a place I could stay.
Okay. I'll gather some like bits of sticks and wood, and if I can find some wood from maybe like the barn, I'll like get some hay and some wood, and I'll like pile it up and just firebolt it.
Start a little fire.
Yeah, pretty much, just a small one. I'll like stick the onion on a stick, and then I'll just hold the onion over, give it a cook.
Yeah. You can feel there's nothing you need to roll for that. You do all of that. That happens. At this point, it is getting dark though.
Yeah.
Between your traveling and your kitchen adventures.
Yep.
It's now around nightfall.
Yeah. So it's cooking an onion. Yep. Like giving it a bite. I'm like, okay. Yep. I've had worse.
And you're
a little bit of a cry.
one tear like, going down your cheek.
Okay.
And you're just you're sitting in front of this fire. Can I make you
mm-hmm. Yep. If any like pigs come over towards me, I'll use minor illusion to like scare them off. Like I'll make
yeah, the barn is much to your favor. The barn is totally deserted.
Oh sweet.
There were farm animals in it at some point, but maybe the farmer's on hard times.
I scouted out real good.
There's some hay and stuff, but no animals. You know,
nice.
Pitchforks and garbage tools. But...
Yeah, cool.
So you're cooking your bits of onion, grilling it and eating it, and then a bolt flies out and actually like knocks the piece of bread that you're about to bite into out of your hands.
Ooh, ouch.
No, yeah, you weren't hit at all, you've lost your bread. So if you added bread to your inventory, you can take it out now, I guess.
You don't pick it up off the floor and shake it and blow it off?
Does it get embedded into the wall, like, into the wall?
Something like that, yeah.
It's like stapled to the wall. I just look at it right and just like... I just turned to whoever did that. I'm like, do you know how much I was enjoying looking forward to eating that? And I'll kind of like stand up and I'll like take a big bite out of the onion. This is what you left with me. Yeah.
Am I talking to him? You turn around and the bolts seem to actually be coming from outside the barn. You're kind of in the center of it, but you know there's a big barn door type area, which is well, there's no door, but you know there's a big barn door sized opening. In the front, and the bolts seem to have come from somewhere on the outside, but
outside, even as a half-elf with your... I think you have dark vision still as a half-elf.
Yes. Yeah.
To 60 feet. Even with that, it's from outside of range.
I'm just like, okay, I don't see anybody. Is the barn, like, there's only one exit out of the barn sort of thing?
Yeah.
Is this, yeah, okay.
I mean, there's just the one big door. One big opening.
I will kind of stand there holding the stick of my young in, and I'll use Mage Hand to, like, reach for the bit of bread that's stapled to the wall.
I like how your life is in danger and you're more worried about the bread.
I'm hungry. I'm holding, like, the stick with the onion, sort of like a sword. I'm, like, holding it out as I'm, like, reaching behind me with my hand, using Mage Hand to try and grab it.
All right. You grab it. That's
okay, fine. Cool. I'll bring it over and I'll kind of, like, put it in my back pocket.
I guess that's your turn.
Yeah. I was waiting to see if anybody answered me.
No one's answering you at all. Did you speak common, by the way, or?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, no one answered you at all. No chance. Two more bolts come flying out from the darkness. Both of those miss also. These drows are shitty.
Level 20 drone elite guy.
Doesn't it hit if it hits your armor class? Doesn't it hit?
Neither of those hit your armor class. They're both.
Because my armor class is 13.
Yeah, but they both rolled 11s.
Oh, 11. Okay. I'm sorry. I'm looking down at 13. Okay, cool.
Yeah, the 13 is your armor class.
Yeah.
A little misleading at first.
Yeah, I get it. I'm not used to seeing that.
So, just both bolts just whiz by your ears. One past your left, one past your right ear. And you can hear the kind of swoosh sound. And they just embed themselves in the back of the barn.
Okay, cool.
But, there's no answer. They're just bolts flying out from the outside.
Okay. I'll be like... Alright. I will make a bolt for it, seeing as I got my bread, and I will run out of the barn and to my left.
As soon as you actually leave the barn door, why? Why does that not have a target and a roll? Stupid cheat. Alright, let's try that again. Yeah. Much better. Oh dear. That hits.
It doesn't, because I cast shield.
Is that what happened?
Yes. I used my reaction. Cast shield and ding!
Wasn't shield plus 2 AC?
No, shield is plus 5 AC.
Is it really?
Yeah. For, until the start of your next turn, you have a plus 5 bonus to AC.
Alright, yeah, sure.
You train your attack, and you take no damage from magic missile.
Yeah, this was kind of still on your turn. As an attack for opportunity, as you're running out of the barn, there was a drow warrior there and kind of tried to slash at your legs, but the shield spell kind of deflected his sword at the last minute.
Yep.
Which is lucky for you. you have maybe once you reach the outside kind of where you're at, maybe 10 more feet of movement, so you can maybe move 10 feet away from the mouth of the barn.
Yep.
You move off to the left, you said?
Yeah. I'm kind of just trying to get around so I can maybe cut off their line of sight of me.
Now that you're a lot closer, and you've obviously seen the one drow that made a slash at you, see that there are actually two kind of on either side of the barn door opening thing, holding those corners, and you see four more kind of off in the distance.
So if I'm running towards one of them, I can just
sort of. They're kind of arranged in like a rough semicircle around the barn, around the opening part at least. So you're running towards one of them, but away from another one. Does that make sense? Yep.
Yeah. I kind of just like as I run and I get hit by one, and I'm turning to run the other one. I kind of just like veer off sideways and try and duck out. I avoid that guy and like head towards out sort of thing. And I just be like, wow. I'm flattered, and I just keep running.
They keep firing at you. Well, that's a hit.
With my armor cloud, my shield.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Well, it's only until the end of your next turn, right?
Yeah.
Oh, is it to the end of your next turn?
Until the start of your next
start.
Turn.
Start.
Gotcha. Yeah, so, well, that hits then.
That does hit, yes.
No! I'm mostly, the 6 damage isn't probably going to be that big a deal. I'm mostly interested in this con save.
Yes. Alright, I shall do that. Oh, yep. I have a 5, but that's a 5. So a
10. So a 10 total?
Yes, 10 total.
You don't immediately fall unconscious like Kira did.
It's me in the leg. I'm kind of
You kind of get you in the leg and you're hobbling and you do kind of feel the poison working its way through you. And you know, it kind of slows you down a little bit. You're hobbling.
Right.
And you're finding, like, your vision blurs a little bit, but you're not on the edge of passing out yet.
Alright. Cool.
Your extremities, your fingertips and your toes go numb, that kind of deal.
Alright. You want to play dirty. Fair enough. Are there any bunched together? Are there any, like, side by side?
The closest ones were the ones right in front of the door.
Yeah.
Kind of on either side.
Okay.
Those are maybe like 10 feet apart. The other ones are really kind of more spread out in this semicircle.
Okay, cool. All right, did I see the one that hit me with the bow?
Yeah. No, he swung at you, so you definitely saw him.
Okay.
The one that hit you with the bowl. It was one of the ones who was in the semicircle.
Okay, cool.
With the crossbow.
I'm guessing he's 30 feet away from me, something like
that? Yeah, 30-ish.
All right, cool. I'll just, like, swing around, and I'll just form this ice shard out of the air, and I'll just throw it at him.
All right.
I shall click the spell so we can do it.
And if you need a target, then click on the little drama.
Boom.
15 DC dex to save.
Mm-hmm.
Suck it.
Oh, you hit him.
He takes 6 damage.
6 damage.
It should have done a roll. Make a ranged spell attack against the target. Because it's a ranged spell attack against the target. And then if it hits, they take 6 damage, and then they do a dex save because it explodes, and anybody within 5 feet of the place it hit
gotcha.
So it didn't roll the
interesting.
I can fix that. It didn't do the attack.
Yeah, for some reason, a lot of the attack checkboxes just aren't checked.
Yeah. All right, I'll do it again, but we'll just keep... Can we just keep the same damage?
Yeah,
we'll
keep the same damage.
Yeah. 11 AC. Alright, so he just takes 4 cold damage.
Does he even take that much? Oh, hit or miss, the shard explodes.
Yeah, hit or miss, the shard explodes, and then they must succeed on dexterity saving throw. He'll take 2d6 cold damage.
Right. Yeah, so he just takes the 4 cold.
Right, so he takes the 4 cold.
4 instead of just the 6.
Oh, well.
Gotcha. And if there's anyone within 5 feet of him.
If there's anybody else,
but there wasn't
take
anybody.
The...
No, the nearest one was kind of a couple feet away.
Alright, that's my turn.
But you you almost get him. It looks like it exploded kind of right above his head, so it was close to being a good hit.
He's kind of one of those ones where it like whizzes past him. He's like, haha, you missed it, and it just explodes behind him. Haha, did I? And I'll use the rest of my turn to just keep running my 30 feet.
Yeah, it's not looking good for you, though.
That's
pursuing
fine.
And firing at you as they go. That's, I mean, you're shielding
enough
at this point, so that hits. That misses, and one more for good measure. That misses. So just 6 more damage, and then one con throw.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, that's a 17. Plus 5.
Okay. 17 plus 5 is more than 13. So
But I'm still poisoned from the first.
Yeah, you're still poisoned. Still hobbling along.
Yeah. Would I be able to dive behind anything to like?
I mean, like you're out in the fields at this point. It's just.
Don't hit me in the back.
I guess like I hadn't pre-decided what crop a field this is. What crops are in these fields, but now it's suddenly important. Like if it's something I have to give you concealment,
I mean, even if you can just tell me what there is a crop of, and one around me.
Kyra says corn, so it's corn.
Okay, cool.
Corn grows tall.
I will kind of like run, and I'll kind of do one of those little like dodge steps where you're like, and then I'll just dive to one side and roll into a ball and cast Minor Illusion to make a cornfield around me.
How does Minor Illusion work again?
It's just a five foot cube of just corn.
Sure, like a five
thing
foot
of just corn. I'm like rolled up in a ball in the middle of this corn.
They have
really...
to investigate to see if they can see through it. If they fail, they leave you alone, which is awesome.
Give me just a second. So the you're standing still in this 5 foot cube of corn, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I'm rolled up in a ball, just like because I kind of dived, sideways, just rolled, and as I like rolled, I went poof, and cast it, and just I'm like laying, I'm just like curled up in a ball inside it.
So the drow kind of run to the last point they saw you, and they kind of scan and you know there's. Pretty big cornfield, not huge, but you know, decently sized. Some of them fire some bolts just randomly through it, and none of them are even close to you. And then they speak some words to each other in a language you don't understand, and then they start.
Oh, what is it?
Do you know Undercommon? But do you know Undercommon?
I do know Undercommon.
Oh yeah, then you actually understand what they're saying. They're saying. Well, he's a wizard. There must be. He could be fooling us. He could be invisible. He could be some glamour. We don't know. Let's try and find him. And then you suddenly as a spellcaster, you recognize the effects of a fairy fire, kind of going off around you and outlining the corn.
Yay! That sucks.
Inevitably, one of them actually hits you.
I'm guessing I'm staying still if I make a dexterity saving throw. That's like to avoid it, so that would be me rolling out of my corn illusion.
I can do that next level! Excited.
You can try to make the dexterity saving throw, but it would involve moving out of your illusion, or you could choose to fail it, and then stand still.
I will see if I can stay in my illusion.
So all around you, you actually see kind of the actual real corn around you. Kind of whenever it's hit by the effects of fairy fire, kind of
light
up and have a purplish outline to it.
Yeah.
As soon as you're hit, you actually look down and you notice that your skin has this purplish outline and your illusion does not.
I'll kind of just be like, okay, I can do this. And I'll just stand up and go, wow, I can't believe you couldn't find me. It's just right in here. This is a corn illusion of a cornfield. Hi, and I'll be talking in Undercommon. And I'll be like, hi, everybody. I'm Farron. How you going? You know, what can I do for you? Sorry about that cold damage before. So, you know,
you
can I help
peacefully?
You with something? Pardon?
Will you come peacefully?
Is that what they're asking me?
Yeah.
Depends where we're going. Are we going to some kind of party? What's going on?
One of them behind you that you didn't even see stabs you in the back with a, with a sword.
Crap! Dang! What the hell?
I think that drops me.
That drops
how
you?
Much, I think like I took, what was it?
You took like before, six or something. Six or four.
The first one hit me for a... The first one hit me for a six. Yeah. Then the
second
because it was
one.
The 25, the one that hit me, the hand crossbow, the one that got me the poison.
Yeah.
And the second one was
the
17. That's 12.
That's 12. 12 plus.
And then the next one was. I'm only at 5. 20, 20. I'm at 5 at the moment.
You're at 5 at the moment?
That takes me, yes.
The last thing you remember is this kind of drow sword stuck through your chest, as and it pulls out. You kind of fall to the ground and
guess
everything goes black. Contrary to how it seems, though, none of you are actually dead. Cool. You come to, some of you come to,
Hey, Martin, can we take a 5-minute break before we go into that? I gotta take care of my son, and I think
absolutely, no problem.
To grab a drink, too. Sweet, thanks.
A 5-minute break sounds good. I'm gonna grab a drink myself.
Alrighty.
You're seen. You, like, you just went to bed, and that's kind of lame, and I actually feel really bad about that.
Oh, not at all, man.
And it worked perfectly.
I fell asleep one night, and that's the way I expected it to be.
Yeah.
Like nothing ever happened.
I mean, at least it's relatively painless, and no,
right?
No getting stabbed in the chest or anything.
Bring it back.
Yeah, I'm cool with it.
It seems like everyone is back. So, contrary to some of what might have seen from those scenes, none of you actually died. You all come to at various points in time, kind of bound and gagged, being led through kind of a what seems to you like a cave, with the some other prisoners and a kind of a prison train, for lack of a better word. Guards in the front, guards in the back. All your equipment's missing. You're all basically wearing like potato sacks, for lack of a better word. Just like totally no armor, no anything.
Do I still have my necklace on?
You don't.
They took a piece of leaf?
They took everything.
They're monsters. Okay.
Literally just everything.
All right, nothing that requires materials. Got it.
Yeah. No
took my lightsaber, man.
No spell components, no anything. The it's kind of difficult to judge the days. You're just being marched, and you know there's no sun, there's no day or night, so it's difficult to judge how many days have passed. But it's definitely several. You go to sleep and wake up several times. And then you finally all separately get to where you are going.
You said we're gagged as well, right?
Yeah, bound, gagged. And they ungag you to feed you and stuff, because it goes on for several days.
All in all, it sounds like we're treated fairly well as far as...
Like, you're kept alive, and you aren't...
weren't, like, beaten or anything like that?
Some of the other prisoners that get real uppity and start screaming and stuff, they get beaten. And in fact, some of them are killed. That just refuse to, like, you know, drag their feet and say, no, I won't go any further, and just killed on the spot.
Well, that I'm gave sure me I energy.
Yeah, sometimes it seems like they kill off prisoners just for the, just to make an example. But eventually you guys are led one by one to an outpost. Your earliest memories of it are just being thrown into the cell, with the gates slammed behind you.
Do we have an idea where we are?
You know you've been underground for what seems to be like a week. But okay. Other than that...
Is everybody in one cell?
Yeah. I actually switched the maps. I don't know if you guys can see where it is. You might have to zoom out to the find.
No, I see it.
I see it.
Ooh.
Everyone's in one cell. And... You are actually sharing a cell, not only with you four, but a gaggle of other assorted creatures. Just a motley crew of weirdos and freaks.
Were we given enough, like, rest to regain spell slots?
Yeah, I mean, like, this is why you just had your HP at full, because it's been, like, a week at this point. So
okay, I was just wondering if they, like, kept us from, like, getting a full sleep so that, you know, they kept us marching, like, on the edge so that we weren't able to... regain spell slots.
No, slowly over the course of the week, you get enough sleep to recover bit by bit.
Okay, cool.
Now I'm feeling like I'm all like, aww. I'm square in this circle world.
Well, I mean, that's totally fine. No pressure at all. You can.
I have been officially pressured.
I'd like to point on a note here, though, Kira, that all the other prisoners that survived are round tokens, and the ones that are no longer with us may have been square tokens.
Hey.
just saying.
Hey. I am square because I'm cute.
Brilliant, you're looking a little bit smooth
there. Cute. I am, are we, now that we're in a cell, are we still gagged and bound?
No, you're no longer gagged, but your kind of rough rope bindings have been replaced with some shackles, some proper metal shackles.
It's a little...
Okay.
The size of the character seems to be inversely proportional to the size of the character.
Yeah, for this particular map, I don't have a grid. It's not a gridded map.
I'm totally messing around. Okay, it's no big deal.
My but head's all, like, fat.
On other maps, it should be better. Like, the tokens will be a proper, like, uniform size, and, like, the distance will be
we
the
are weird. So complaining! I'm going to keep complaining until I get my way. No, I'm just playing.
But you asked if the shackles were in the front?
Yeah, are they in the front?
They are in the front. They're also tied to, like, a metal belt you have, and your feet are also shackled together. So you can walk, but you can't, like, run very fast. And you kinda
I
like,
could so get out of this, but I'm going to kind of, like, sit
you,
a bit.
You can try.
Is this a door, or is this,
this is a like a barred door.
All right, so we can see through it.
Yeah, you can see through it.
They didn't, barring that they didn't take any... okay, question. Is there anything in the cell that seems that would, like, dampen magic or something like that? Like, do I see anything all sparkly glittery?
No,
like, can I do an investigation or a arcane or something?
You can try and investigate. You know, definitely nothing glittery and, like, overt like that. Speaking of which, Farron, for the trip, they did seem to keep an extra eye on you. Since you did reveal yourself to be a spellcaster, they definitely had, like, an eye on you the entire time. It always felt like there was always, like, two people with eyes on you at all times, and you like kind of learn to, like, speak very slowly to make sure that, like, you're I'm not casting any spells.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Make
I
your
was
movements
like,
very steady. Like, I'm not doing any
weird. He fought back and succeeded. I fought back and I failed miserably. Since I failed miserably, you don't care about her.
Did we just get thrown into the cell? Did the door just get slammed, or what's...
Yeah, I mean, like, realistically, we'd all be arriving, like, it'd be a hell of a coincidence if you all four arrived at the exact same time, but let's just go with it. Yeah, you guys have just been thrown in. The door is slammed. Just now, so, yeah.
I turn around as the guards are... You know, I don't know. I'll save that for later. I'm just going to be quiet for a second. But I did want to check. Can I do like an arcane or investigation or something? Magical barrier-wise or something. I want to know, like... Because I'm really trying to check to see if they can hinder our magical abilities down here. Or if it's just, we're just going to shackle you and keep our eyes on you.
You can, like, roll an investigation. Like, that would be more like physically searching around for, right, like, an object.
Well, that is what I'm going to do.
Okay, yeah.
All right, so, investigation.
Would you say these shackles prohibit semantic components? I'll try, anyway. I'll tell you what I'm going to try.
Okay.
I'm gonna try prestidigitation. I'm just gonna try and make a... small musical note, just toot.
12.
Barely audible. Moves away from the door.
And they actually make you a little bit bigger, Brill, because this is actually, you're looking real shrimpy. A little bit better.
I have enough self-confidence that it's all right. So he kind of moves out into the middle of the room to survey, like, what's... And actually... what going on? What are we doing here?
I'm gonna head over here.
Who are you people?
I should probably
surveying the room. Missing anyone.
Right.
I'm just kind of looking around. Excuse me, pardon me. Hoping nobody gets mad at me since I look like the thing that just basically trapped them in there.
Much to your surprise, there's actually another drow in here also.
Yeah,
this one over here is another drow.
Oh.
Hello. While you guys are investigating the room, I'll get to what you guys see. The prestidigitation, this is like it's a simple, super simple spell that you've done 1,000 times before. Yep. Just to like test.
Just trying to make a small musical note, just to see if I can do it and to see if it works.
And it's like a musical note that you've done so many times, you like know it by heart. Like you can like hear it practically. But it's you can't hear it this time. It's just actually all in your head. Like you can like hear what it's supposed to sound like, but you don't actually hear anything in your ears. You're pretty sure you got the movements right and the words right, and the whole deal. You
felt that sucks.
You felt some magic leaving your body. The spell was expended, but there was no musical note whatsoever. Actually, it's a cantrip, so nothing left your body at all.
Yeah.
Did anyone respond to Brill?
I'll get to you in a bit.
I'm just like,
I'm going to describe the room which you're speaking sure. to, and Kyra is investigating anyway, so it's kind of two birds with one stone.
I just plop down in the corner. Just be like, fine.
In the room, you see a. Would any of you know what a Koa-Toa is? Like a large fish creature. Like a.
Would I know from my research?
Yeah, I'm actually going to have you, as the researchy one, be the stand-in for the bard, as the one who knows things. You would know what a Koa-Toa is.
Okay, cool.
Especially
I just kind of sit down and just survey them.
Yeah, your research was specific to like Underdark races and the origin of the Underdark, too, right? So yeah, you would definitely know what a Koa-Toa is.
I'm just like Drow, Koa-Toa, Dwarf, Snifeblin. I'm just like naming them all under my breath.
You see a Koa-Toa here, just a huge fish creature, and he oddly enough he's kind of sitting cross-legged and he's got his palms extended outward on top of his knees and he's just kind of making the fishy equivalent of what would be like an om.
Okay.
He comes off as a. and it's he seems very relaxed, but it's not at all having a calming effect on anyone else. In particular, there is kind of a mean-spirited orc in the corner who seems very, very annoyed with the noise and just everything in general. And every now and again, goes over and starts yelling at him and kind of. Pushing him around, trying to like get a reaction and trying to bully him, but there's just no reaction at all from the Koa-Toa.
Mm-hmm.
In the corner, you kind of see huddled close together and speaking a deep gnome, a Snurf Sneblin, speaking with a female shield dwarf. And there's this small, weird mushroom creature. Which I don't think any of you would know, even with the research. Kind of rubbing up against the...
nature, and what I've known a little bit about these creatures, possibly.
Roll what would you roll? Knowledge nature, I guess.
Okay.
Are they speaking common, or something?
No, they're kind of whispering to each other. You can't even hear their conversation from...
Natural 20.
Natural 20. Yeah, you actually do know a bit about these creatures. They are Myconids, a race of kind of sentient mushrooms.
Interesting.
This one seems to be very small, very young.
Aw, what could they possibly have done? Jeez.
Over here, you see two deep gnomes kind of speaking in hushed tones to each other, kind of very much avoiding eye contact and keeping to themselves, not looking at anyone else around them. They look very similar. One is male, kind of bald, and the other has little tufts of hair. So, a female. And but they don't seem to be interested in anything else that's happening. In the corner here, kind of being sullen and not speaking to anyone else is an elf who just kind of looks on at you guys, but not saying anything. Just kind of watching the situation and taking it on.
In the corner.
Pardon?
Being Aragorn in the corner of the prince.
Yeah, kind of. Much less badass than Aragorn, because you know, rather than having like a hood over his eyes and the sword and the whole thing, and you know,
does. He's like wearing a potato sack in prison.
Yeah, yeah.
So the effect is much lessened, but it's the same kind of like not speaking, keeping to yourself type of deal. Up here is probably the largest prisoner of all, even bigger than the Koa-Toa. A creature which Farron would recognize as a Quaggoth.
Which are normally there?
No, over here.
Okay.
They're, you know, normally just vicious and feral, and most of them are in service to the drow. This one kind of seems a little different. His posture is very upright. He's almost like holding himself, sticking his chest out a little bit, almost like he's trying to convey a... Yeah, it's self-important, which is just not a trait you normally associate with Quaggoths at all. They're normally just kind of more bestial and animalistic.
Okay.
And finally over here, you have... it's not quite a dwarf. But it's kind of like a skinnier dwarf-like creature with a wild beard, bald head.
Okay.
Kind of a maybe a little bit of a crazy look in his eyes, but and again, not saying anything, just sitting down and contemplating a situation. Were you speaking to anyone in particular? Kira, you don't find any particular objects of any kind. Nothing that looks remotely magical. Just rocks, cave walls.
Yeah. After Brill goes, and after anybody else goes, and I want to say something to this.
Sure. Were you speaking to anyone in particular, Brill?
No, actually, I was totally addressing the room, and once I saw the orc, I would, as soon as they throw me in here, I'm kind of like, I said that, I said, what's going on, what are we doing here, who are you people, and then, go ahead.
No, you go ahead,
Well, then, as soon as I see the orc, I would say, because I say that in common, I would see the orc and say to him, "Hey, who are you? How long have you been here? What is this place?"
Mm-hmm. The orc actually, as soon as you start addressing the room, he stops bullying the Koa-Toa, and turns to kind of notice you and take you in. And he's also kind of surprised to see, someone with orcish blood in the room and. When you address him specifically, he just walks up and says, what tribe are you from?
I have no tribe.
You have no tribe? And then you have no honor. And he just refuses to, speak to you at all.
Yeah, I kind of expected it.
He actually kind of gives you a small shove on the shoulder. As he walks away, as he turns, you have no honor. You not a very hard show, but just enough to make a point.
And I say to his back, I make my own honor, and leave it at that.
He goes back to trying to get a reaction out of the Koa-Toa, and it's continuing to fail.
I'll turn back to the rest of the room and say, just see if anyone is answering, we in jail? What's going on?
No one seems to be coming forward to address you. And they're all kind of wrapped up in their own business.
Well, it's obviously not a party, is it? I'll just say that from sitting down on the ground.
Oh, while I'm checking...
I was promised a party.
Brill kind of chuckles and says, well, we can make it, party.
Yeah, look at all this cake we have. Oh,
and he gets grinds his knuckles together, grinds one fist into his other hand.
Well, I don't know about you, but I had an onion a week ago.
I don't explain the smell.
Ever since then, you've been kind of eating these really a thin mushroom broth. And it's been just barely nutritious enough to keep you going, but not at all. The onion seems like a dream right now.
Yes,
that's flavor.
That's why I was basically like, you know, I've had worse.
But Kira was going to do something after Brill was done with this, I guess.
Well, I was thinking as I was looking around, going, excuse me, pardon me, uh-huh. trying to be polite about looking to see if there's anything, because I really wanted to see if there was going to like be maybe blocking some of our arcane kind of thing. I run into the drow, and I'm like, whoa! Hi! Why are people so mean? And I ask that honestly, like as if I'm not even a drow.
He just kind of gives you a raised eyebrow and answers, do you speak undercommon by any chance?
Yes, I do.
He answers, were you speaking in undercommon to him?
No, I was speaking in common.
He answers back in undercommon, though, like, what do you mean, you people?
And I go, oh, you can speak that. Okay. And then I say, undercommon, and I say, well, you know, they're just so mean, and we didn't do anything, and we were just standing there, and me and my companion, we were just trying to have a nap, and they just come in, wait, what are you doing here?
You don't seem to be from around here. You're definitely not part of the garrison. Are you one of those, I'm always so shitty at pronouncing fantasy names. The chaotic good drow goddess, the moon one, moon goddess. You don't know who I'm talking about?
Lolth?
I think so.
Not Lolth. It's Elias.
I think so. I think that in kind of looking up this character, I might have ran across that. Do I really know? Not really.
Elstree? It's spelled like that. Is that Elstree?
Yeah. Elstree, okay. Yeah.
I have seen that name. Do I know exactly? No, I don't.
So he actually asked you, are you one of these Elstree worshippers? You seem kind of...
are they like
lightheaded.
The good witch? Is that kind of like what we're dealing with?
Yeah, you would probably, I mean, I'm sure if you're like your stepmom told you about the drow, then you would have heard of her. She's kind of the goddess of the good drow. There's kind of a section of drow that just want to live on the surface underneath the moon, and they're known for like dancing naked beneath the stars, and it's very much like a pseudo-pagan type of deal.
Okay, I'm going to say, I have heard of her, but no, I no, I'm just not from around here.
It shows.
Oh, why are you down here?
That's my business. None of yours.
Well, I was just trying to make conversation since we have to be bunkmates and all, but okay.
We are not bunkmates.
But we're not bunkmates?
No.
Like, but we're all okay, it was nice meeting you! And then I just keep going, and I'm like looking for like more of that arcane stuff kind of thing, and work my way back to Raven.
Sure.
And I say...
Arcane friends, are you?
But, okay, well, I guess I would have looked around here. Would you have said something? Because if I would have heard you laugh,
I was gonna let out a sigh when you said bunkmates, and I'm just like, let out a sigh, and I'm coming, and I'm just like, we don't even have beds.
I'm assuming I hear that.
Yeah, I said it in undercommon. You can hear it if you want.
And I probably turn around and say, who said that? Who said that? And I just look around because I'm thinking we're the only two drow in the room, so I'm looking around like, who said that? And then I kind of shrug it off and then go back and finish talking to the guy that I was talking to and then go back and, you know, excuse me, went my way back to Raven and I kind of whisper and say, I don't think they're blocking magic. I don't know, but, you know, maybe I can transform into like a rat and then maybe hide in a corner, and maybe somebody could yell, there's a prisoner loose, and maybe they'll open the door, we can bum rush them, or I don't know, we gotta get out of here. And that's what I say to Raven, like, quietly, in his ear.
Yeah. We do.
Like, that's the only plan I can think of. That's all I say.
So knowing that the other four kind of came in with me, I would actually walk over to the dwarf and maybe ask her, Mistress Dwarf, how long you be here?
She kind of looks you up and down and says, I saw you talking to Ront over there. You're not with him, are you?
I kind of snarl at him, like, no, him no good.
You're right. Him no good, she says, slightly patronizingly.
But they're so mean around here, I swear.
What was your original question again?
I'll say it more clearly. Mistress Dwarf, I was trying to be as polite as possible. Right. I said, how long you be here? How long have you been here?
She kind of sighs. It's hard to tell. I mean, there's no sun or moon down here to measure against. But maybe 10 days, maybe 2 weeks. It's hard to say.
You know why we're here?
We're slaves.
Huh? Gabriel, gets taken aback. He's pretty young, but, slaves? Yeah, he never even would have imagined.
You know the drow take slaves, right?
Might not know much about drow.
Oh, well, you're about to learn. You seem like an alright fellow. I'm Eldeth. And this here, she kind of points to the deep gnome to her left. This is Jimjar. And this little guy here, she kind of pats the mushroom creature on the head. This is Stool.
Well met, Eldeth. Well met, Jimjar. My is Brill, War Priest of Tor.
As soon as she pats Stool on the head, kind of a burst of spores bursts out from and as soon as you breathe in some of these spores, you can actually hear a voice in your head saying, "Hello,
creepy!
Hello, I'm Stool."
And then Brill quirks his head to the side like a dog maybe or something like, well met, Stool.
Kira would actually know that this is how Myconids communicate telepathically.
Okay, so then I wouldn't say that.
Myconids are native to the Underdark, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. But they're kind of obscure. Like, they mostly keep to themselves, and they don't have lots of interactions with the surface at all.
Okay. I was wondering if I would have maybe heard of them, read about them or something.
My nobi slave, you try break free?
How? We're jackhole up tight. There are at least a dozen guards outside. The priestess who runs this outpost is vicious. There's no escape. How can we escape? We have no equipment. We have no weapons. We have nothing.
We have our minds. And our bodies. There always be way.
Maybe. Well, if your mind thinks of a plan, I'd be interested to hear it, but I can't think of anything.
The whole time that since I've tried to cast the spell, I'm looking at the shackles to see if that was the reason why magic didn't work.
What was that?
After I tried to cast prestidigitation, it didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
I've been looking at my shackles.
Yeah.
To see if that was the reason why.
As far as you can tell, they're pretty ordinary shackles.
Okay. And I've been looking at them to see if I could figure a way of getting them unlocked or getting my hands out.
There's a kind of a lock you could maybe pick if you had a lockpick, or a lockpick analog.
Yeah.
But you do not. It seems like a difficult lock to pick, more difficult than your average indoor, something. But definitely not impossible. Definitely not like beyond your wildest dreams of ever picking.
I'll try once more with prestidigitation, and I'll try and create just a thin bit of metal in my hand. Non-magical trinket. I'll have an illusionary. I thought it was you could make something that was real.
No, I would call like a thin metal rod a non-magical trinket. That's fine.
Yeah. Or an illusionary image. Okay, yeah.
I guess it only lasts until the end of your next turn. You try and nothing comes up anyway.
Yeah.
All right. Like you're pretty sure you got
now
the.
I'm sure it's not working.
Yeah. Yeah. You're sure it's not working. You're positive. You got the words right. The movements, right?
So Brill says to them, says, "My think on it." And then he walks over to the door and starts investigating the cage we're in.
The bars are kind of made of a dark metal that you're not familiar with. It's kind of cold to the touch, but it's just kind of cold in general down here. Around the parts that aren't the door, they're pretty pretty tightly spaced. You can still see through, but it's much narrower. There's a section that actually is like a door frame built into these kind of wall of bars.
Mm-hmm.
And that has like a proper window where the bars are slightly further spaced apart, where maybe you could get like your arm through if it wasn't shackled to your other arm.
Mm-hmm.
That's about it. You don't see a keyhole or anything on the inside.
How long has it been since our last rest?
You've been resting pretty consistently on the way over here. So, maybe 12 hours.
Okay. And I have one last question for the moment. I'm supposed to have a pet mouse, and I'm wondering if it's still with me.
No.
Poor thing.
I mean, like, all you have on you is, like, your sack, right? And it's, like, not in your sack. Your sack cloth that you're wearing, so.
If you ever mention that, I swear I'm going to run up to you and, like, sit in your pocket.
You don't know where your mouse is. It could be alive, but ever since you fell asleep with like it kind of, like cuddled up next to you under that tree, you haven't seen or heard or felt it since.
Okay, so I'm pretty seething about that.
Yeah, I mean, I could see that.
Yeah.
And I will kind of. So, all right. Can I see anything outside of the door?
All right. Sure. Yeah.
I'm sorry if you answered me, I didn't hear it. How long has it been approximately since our last rest?
Like 12-ish hours.
Probably pretty exhausted, or at least getting tired.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, it's getting to be around bedtime.
Yeah. So can we see anything through the bars?
Seeing things through the bars, there's kind of a platform of sorts right in front of you.
Okay.
It's difficult to see through the bars, but it seems like there are maybe some stairs.
How far apart are the bars?
The bars that aren't part of the little window in that's attached to the door are maybe like half an inch apart. They're really close together.
Do Raven and Kira say anything to me as I'm kind of like poking around at the door?
Kira probably wouldn't say anything. She's kind of shy. Like, she only talked to the guy because it looked like her. Like, the guy because he looked like me. And I've never seen Drow. Besides the ones that attacked us. Which is why I asked him, why are your people so mean? Other than that, I would have to get to know you before I start really talking to you.
So you think you see some stairs out down here. Okay. That kind of lead down on, it would be on your right looking out.
Got it.
And there's like maybe a rope bridge, but it's kind of hard to tell straight ahead. It kind of descends out into the darkness.
So I would kind of say sort of kind of under my breath or kind of over my shoulder, not really particularly to anyone, but generally in their direction. I would say, how are we going to get out of here?
I look at Raven.
Yeah, I'm kind of posing it to Raven and Kira, but like not directly. But I'm definitely saying it loud enough that they can hear me. Probably nobody else at the back of the room, but for sure, at the very least, the two of them would hear me.
I'll stand up and I'll just be like, "Hi, everybody. How's your day being? Just wondering if anybody would have any sort of piece of metal on them or something like that. Maybe someone smuggled in something. Just putting it out there, just a question. I know it's a long shot, but just thought I'd ask."
I giggle. I just straight up giggle because I'm thinking I have on rags and I have metal on my hands. So I just start giggling.
I laugh and say, "Well, maybe we can turn these shackles into scrap metal."
Well, I mean, that's the plan once we get them off, but I need something to get them off.
Do I get a sense that I might be able to break out of them?
I mean, they're very hard, but you could try.
Kira, I have an idea. I've seen you change into a number of things. Are you able to change into anything that might have a bite that can be corrosive?
Oh, let me see. Poison. Hold on. I'm going to go rack my brain. Just give me a sec. I have so picked up the slight stupidity from my sister that she has. Like, I'm a little bit more intelligent, but I'm kind of like... Yeah, your people are not my people. And it's like, what? Like, you're so racist. Yeah, I am. I pretty much am.
Freaking break. Yeah, I don't think there's anybody in the room is strong enough to break these chains.
Right. You could try. I would make you roll for it, and it would kind of represent, like, more or less a couple hours worth of, like, straining against them.
Okay. So I will give it a shot. I'll go Don Dokken on this and break the chains around me.
If you roll for it, that's going to represent, like, basically until you go to bed. Like, this is what you're doing, is you're, like, working and struggling against the chains, trying to weaken them bit by bit until you actually stop.
Maybe not, then. I'm not as strong as I am finesse.
I can poison as far as, I can, you know, turn into something poisonous.
What, from something
corrosive?
Poison?
Not, like, really corrosive. I mean...
Brill will actually go and sit next to the half-elf since he kind of appreciated the jokes he was making and wants to think more about how we're going to break out of these. So he will actually start working to try to, like, he's, like, trying to move, well, break the chains, yeah.
I was asking everybody in the room if anybody had anything, like a piece of metal or something like that. Maybe someone just smuggled something in on the, like, inside of the sack or something. Did anybody answer me?
Well, I did, but I didn't, you know, it was more of a joke.
I tell him just a poisonous snake.
None of the NPCs answer you all.
Pretty much.
Okay.
All right.
That's,
well, I all can right. turn to this.
Cool.
I want
to,
okay.
Like, I'm
sorry.
Alright, 17 strength check. Well, I'm assuming it was just a straight strength check, athletics or something.
No, it's a straight strength check. So again, this represents you, like...
I'm going to spend another hour or so, like, working them while I'm just sitting around and getting ready to sleep.
Yeah, you go into a corner and you kind of strain and struggle against them. You kind of try to twist and weaken them as best you can, and you're pulling and you try different angles and stuff. And you just can't get them.
Kind of break off a piece of them or something. Yeah.
Nothing at all. Nothing. Okay. There's just no progress made at all with that roll.
While I'm sitting there, at some point I will say to, I'll introduce myself. I say, "My Brill, might think you're right. We need lockpick. If I have lockpick, I might be able to get out.
Yeah, me too. I mean, that's why I was asking around, but apparently everybody's a bit light on the equipment side, which is understandable, because we are sort of imprisoned in a drow hole.
There's a lot of creatures here, except for the orc. That's, you know, a lot of them are from underground, I'm assuming, or I've been given this information. I don't know if they're skill abilities.
The dwarf is also a surfacer. But other than that,
this one?
This one right here?
The female?
Yeah, the shield dwarf.
Is her buddy, like, something she met here? Or do we get the feeling that they know each other? Yeah. Or is it, like, something that kind of came with her?
You could go and talk to them and you know.
Yeah, I'm going to try something. Like, we're talking about, when Raven's asking me about, like, poisonous things, and I'm just going to say, I'm just going to try something. Let's see if it works. So I go up to the little gate here, or whatever, the cell door. I kind of put my back to it and kind of take a look to see, like, you know, if nobody's, like, really paying attention to me kind of thing.
Yeah.
And when I find a moment where nobody's paying attention, I want to turn into a spider. I want to try to see if it works.
So this is something you've done several times before, obviously, during your druid training. And you kind of try to fall back on that, and you try to feel your connection with the nature and the land around you. And it's almost like you're calling, but nothing's answering.
Damn it! And I just tell him, I go back up to Raven and say, I can't. That's all I say is, I can't. I'm like doing one of those like I'm losing my mind. Like, I can't do this thing that I always do. What do I do? Kind of thing. That's pretty much.
Please check your number and try again.
Damn it.
After I sat down, I would say directly to Baron and say, my Brill, who you be?
Hi, Brill, how you going? I'm Farron. Nice to meet
you. I've been better. Yeah. Although, this is not first time I be in rags.
Well, I mean...
I thought he was going to say this is not the first time I be in prison.
That's a good way to meet somebody.
Not a kid.
I mean, it's not
the first time I've been in prison. In fact, that's probably how I met my kind of mentor, Beric. He probably got me out of jail because I was too young to be in jail.
That's fair.
So how'd you get here? I was enjoying this lovely cooked onion when I was attacked by some drow. They invited me to some party and then stabbed me in the back. So
your mouth waters a little involuntarily as you say cooked onion. You may kind of like drool just a little bit out of the corner of your mouth. You gotta wipe it away real quick.
Not know my fell asleep next to tree and wake up in chains.
So pretty uneventful for you. Okay. Well, have you having any luck there trying to break out of these chains? I see you struggling a bit.
Yeah, you can see the like muscles are bulging on my arms, and I'm getting a little sweaty. And I don't say anything, but I just shake my head, kind of in frustration.
Keep working. no offense, but I mean, you've got a big toad man over there, a big fish man. And you also have he's a full-blooded orc, right?
Yes, a full-blooded orc.
You also got that guy over there, full-blooded orc. I mean, no offense, but I've heard stories that aren't full-blooded orcs a little bit more stronger than half-orcs. I mean, you know, you're part human, like me.
I look at the other orc and kind of scoff.
Well, I mean, I'm guessing he's been here for a while, so, because he's got a bit of a pole up his ass. Ooh, I wonder if we could use that to pick the lock.
I definitely laugh at that. Yeah, most work like that.
Well, I'm not sure if brute strength is going to get us out of this situation, so I've tried to do a little bit of, you know, doodle, you know, and I just kind of like make this like, you know, but it didn't work. So.
Hey, elf lady, why are you making so much noise?
And I kind of...
Sorry, for those not seeing the chat, Kira's been yelling for a guard for the last few minutes.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, say, okay. I say, elf lady. And I start looking around, like, did I see an elf lady as I walk by? And I'm just like,
yelling.
Hello. Were you
hello?
Talking to me? I don't talk to strangers.
My was.
I'm sorry.
In that case, my Brill. Who you be?
And I look at Raven. Like, is it okay? Like, are they gonna bite me?
Yes, I permit you to talk to strangers.
I know, I'm talking to this crazy looking elf. It can look like me.
Stranger danger. Stranger danger.
Yeah, pretty much. Help.
Kira, who are we conversing with?
This is like the first time I've seen her because I've been pretty much like
my bro. My bro, who you be?
I am Raven.
I'm not saying that in any rude way. I'm just like just saying it. I'm real.
Oh, no, I am Raven. I seem to be in the same lot as you are, although our current situation looks like it has no solution.
This is the first time I've seen Kira because I've been like guarded most of the time, so I'm just like, I just like put on the charm, and I'm just like, wow, you are beautiful. I mean, did anybody else just feel that? I mean, did it just get brighter in here? I mean, wow.
I start turning around, looking like, who is he talking to?
And I just kind of like stand up and be like, hi, I'm Farron, how you going?
And still looking behind me and looking around.
I'll put out my hand to you.
Both hands? Because they're in chains.
Oh, just one hand, like, shake my hand.
All right,
no, I
like...
know, but I know. We're all in chains, right?
So. Like that?
Yeah, I'm kind of like, I'm trying to be as suave as possible.
You got maybe, like, 2 feet of chain between your hands at like, maximum distance.
Ignore the chain.
Ooh, 2 feet.
More
you
or less.
Choke somebody. I'm going to start a riot.
Yeah, you could.
I am thinking of ways to get out. Okay.
That's a decision you can make.
That is a decision that I just might make.
So it's not like a metal bar or like cuffs. Is that
no, so it's you've got like a cuff around your wrist and there's like a chain attached to it. Mm-hmm. And it's attached to the other cuff on your other wrist. And about halfway through, it's connected to a like belt cuff you have around your waist. And that's connected to kind of a similar getup around your ankles.
I got you. So we're more like chain gang style.
Yeah, it's really kind of chain gang style. Like, you can move around, you can walk fine.
Are our feet connected to our
we can't move, like,
yes.
30 feet. Yeah. We're, like, half speed sort of thing.
All right.
Ankle to ankle, wrist to wrist, and then a chain from the wrists to the waist to the ankles.
Okay,
yeah,
gotcha.
But, like, leaving you with enough mobility to, like, do things with your arms more or less unimpeded, sort of. Like, you can't wave them around in the air. Or, you know, anything really complicated. But you can, like, do something simple in front of you, or you can walk just fine.
As Farron says that, I as I'm looking around, I notice all, like, I'm imagining there's, like, urine and feces and stuff. Like, we missed the... Is that, like, going on here, or is this fairly clean?
And so, there's one corner where that seems to have, like, a lot of feces and urine and stuff, and then there also seems to be like, this big orc turds scattered around in various
what
places.
What corner is that, by the way?
Yeah, that's exactly. Like, we're not that standing corner. In that corner, are we?
It's actually like right here, next to, between the drow and.
So I would have seen that as I was investigating.
Yeah.
I'd be like, ew. Okay, let me like avoid this. And you choose. He chooses to stand near the feces. What is wrong with this guy?
He doesn't seem to bother him that much, and it's also kind of like a
so uncouth.
Like you could sense it as you were near him. Like, you wanted to leave because of the smell. And okay. Maybe he's using that to his advantage.
Maybe he has no sense of smell.
But there's also, like, some orc turds just, like, in the middle of the room and, like, near the Koatoa and, like...
Oh, maybe we can mage hand some orc turds in somebody's face.
Yeah, I can't.
But mage hand doesn't seem to work.
Okay. Anyway, so when Farron says that, I'm still kind of looking around, and then when I realize it's me, I kind of turn like a little like purple, I'd imagine, because I can't really turn red.
Yeah.
So and then I kind of turn around and face the other direction, and like, and then just wait until it kind of goes away. Okay. And I don't say anything.
I just kind of look over at, you know, the elf and be like, it's like in motion with my head, like, is this normal?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I turn back around when I'm like, okay, I'm like, ah. And I look at Raven like, it's okay to talk to them, right? Like, they're not going to eat us or whatever. Like, that kind of thing.
No, this thing over here to my right. Like this thing over here. He hasn't eaten us, and these guys aren't going to eat us.
Okay. I say, Kyra? And I kind of wave. I don't hold my hand out, but I wave.
That's right. I put my hands away. Wow.
I say, I don't mean to be mean. I'm shy. And that's all I say.
Any chance I can make some kind of a knowledge check? I do have some religion. If I can make like a religion check on Brill to see if I can pick up on his faith of Torm.
Sure. I feel like that would be enough to pick up a sign, but it really depends on how obvious Brill makes it.
Oh, yeah, I don't try to hide it. In fact, yeah, you might have heard me say it, because I'm not trying to be quiet or anything. When I talked to the dwarf, you might have heard me say, she's the only one I introduced myself to formally. Again, just being that she's a dwarf, I kind of have a little bit of familiarity with dwarven culture, so I was trying to be more, you know, robust in my introduction. So you might have heard me say, you know, War Priest of Torm to her. War Priest of Torm.
And I'm sure it's like you're struggling against the cuffs. You might be like, ah, Torm, help me. You know,
Definitely. Yeah, for sure.
All right, well, I'll inquire. You follow Torm?
I have found my way to his door. I wish to be strong and a mighty warrior, and he has blessed me in many ways.
Kira, it would appear that we have found perhaps a good ally here. What little I know of Torm is that we're in good company. Let me just put it that way.
I say, okay, Kyra.
I kind of brighten at that. So Brill is still fairly young, so I kind of brighten at that and kind of take it as a compliment. That'd be right. He's just kind of like smiling.
I'm still leaving. Just...
Well, seeing as we just arrived and all these other lovely people have been here for a while, maybe we should ask them what the general procedure sort of thing is. Do we get let out? I mean, we're slaves, apparently, but are we just kept here? Or do we actually get sent somewhere to do something? I'll look over to the Quaggoth, because he's all like, he's obviously giving him some sort of self-importance, and maybe
he's a bit more,
you know, before you speak to him, maybe a suggestion. Perhaps you could say the orc on the other side says he doesn't think you can break my chains.
He says that to who?
Well, I'm just saying you can maybe approach the Quaggoth with that, saying, you know, the orc on the other side of the room over there says, you know, doubts that you can break my chains. What say you? You think you can break my chains? Yeah, I don't know.
Try and get him to...
I'd try and convince him, but he'd probably punch me in the face.
Well, I mean, talk about... I mean, if... Get, like, the strong people to see if they can... I mean, not my chains, personally. I mean, because I don't want to get, like, thrown around or anything like that, but sure.
I mean, so I'd like to bargain, but I have nothing to give.
I could maybe try and wiggle out, but
who looks like they're the weakest? In the
The weakest.
Yeah, like if I were to like go and take my chains and go strangle them, like, you know, I'd have like a decent chance of not getting killed.
Like, Stool is probably objectively the weakest in that he's just like.
Oh, not the. He's cute.
He's a fun
yeah.
guy.
Yeah, he's very fun.
Stool is like 2 feet tall and just like hobbles around like on one leg and then the other leg and one leg and then the other, like kind of like a little kid almost.
Yeah, I'm not gonna hurt anything. Spoil you in the face and be like that is so not what I'm gonna do.
Like the gnomes are pretty small.
Okay. I'm thinking about what Raven is saying, and I'm just thinking of, like, maybe who I can try to, like... I mean, I think if we start a big old huge fight, then, like, maybe...
Yeah, I mean,
they'll
like,
come. They'll come check on us.
Like a prison riot or something. Or,
yeah, that's...
Like, you've done a mage hand with, like, poo.
Right, which is why I was thinking about, hey, can we mage hand some poo in somebody's face? You know, that's gotta get somebody angry.
I will, mention over this Quaggoth and be like, "Hi, Mr. Quaggoth, how you going? I'm Farron, you know. For what we have, you know, sort of a nice day, I suppose. I mean,
so that's very he can answer you. So that's very familiar to be addressing me in such a way. I am Prince Derendil.
Prince Derendil, nice to meet you, Prince. My name is Sel Farron D'Arian. These are my lovely people that arrived with me at the same time.
I wave.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. How do you do? Of course. You can. He's actually answering you in Elvish the whole time.
Okay. Cool. I will talk to him in Elvish.
Like.
Yeah.
So.
My voices are terrible, but I'm trying to go for like a very like snobby, like almost aristocratic kind of voice.
So all of us understand except for Brill. You don't understand Elvish.
No, do not.
Okay.
I can translate for him.
So I say, so what seems to be like the order of business here? Do we just sit here all day, you know, pooing over in that corner, or what do we do?
I giggle. I think that's so funny.
Well, in the mornings we're worked, and I'm just gonna drop the voice. I just this is terrible. In the mornings we're worked, and in the evenings we're mostly left to our own devices, like we are now. Depending on the tasks we have, it could last all day or just half a day. We're fed once a day, and we sleep. And then eventually we're going to be transported to Menzo Branson.
They have to open the door when they feed us.
So they come and get us in the morning, take us somewhere to work, feed us in the middle of the day.
Yes, they assign us jobs. Sometimes we're breaking rocks. Sometimes we're
that sounds
food.
Like just a hoot.
Sometimes we're cleaning.
Oh, I like to clean too. Maybe if we clean really, really well, they'll just let us go.
I doubt it.
Yeah.
Quaggoth, if I may inquire, first of all, you're...
Excuse me, sir. It may not be obvious to you, but I'm not a Quaggoth. I am an elf prince. I've been polymorphed to this form by an evil wizard.
I say he's delusional.
Yes, and it is very obvious to all of us that this is the case, isn't it? I mean, of course.
You've heard of my kingdom, Nelrindenvane, in the high forest on the surface. Surely
have we heard of that?
You can roll for it.
Okay.
knowledge.
Oh, I want to roll for that too.
Yeah, everyone.
Nobility. I studied
history,
something.
Knowledge.
Never heard of.
Yeah, in fact, because you're with the nobility in Evermeet, you'd roll with advantage.
Okay.
Oh, we're rolling history. Okay, cool.
History or like intelligence or.
Ooh, my history is awful.
Proficiency.
That's all I can tell. Okay, so I'm gonna roll it anyways.
Oh, that is a 6.
Down,
so 11.
Down. Let's see what we're going to do. You know what? I'm going to roll 2. Whatever's the highest, I'm taking. Okay, a 2 and a 14. 15.
15?
Yes.
And then you got a 11, I think you said?
Yeah, I rolled 6 plus 5.
So none of you are, besides Kira, are especially confident in your knowledge of elven kingdoms, especially given that some of them tend to be kind of secretive.
Yeah.
Kira, you feel moderately confident that you've never heard of this kingdom.
I giggle. I'm like...
None of you have heard of it, but most of you are kind of like, I haven't heard of that, but that sounds like it could be a thing, maybe, okay. I don't know.
And we're talking to this guy right here, right?
No,
Arcana check?
Oh, this guy here. Okay.
Like he really has been polymorph?
That's the fish guy. The
I just want to go over there and whisper in his ear, "You're lying!" Just so where he can hear it.
The insight check. You are positive that he thinks he's telling the truth. Like, he's not intentionally deceiving you.
I'm sure, because I didn't do an insight. So he's lying. Yeah, but whoever else does
the insight, Raven did the insight check. It's kind of an outlandish story. He might be mistaken. He might be, you know, anything could have happened to him. But he definitely thinks he's telling the truth.
Okay. I whisper that in his ear.
You go and you whisper, like, "You're lying." He's like,
"You're lying.
Ma'am, excuse me. I'll have you remind you, you're addressing a prince. I won't have my name besmirched like this."
It's interesting you were polymorphed into a quagoth, though. Of all things, that seems quite almost cursing.
It's quite a curse. I've been... deposed and exiled from my throne, and my kingdom is in danger, and they need me.
Who had this vendetta for you?
The evil wizard, Terastor? Terastor. He wanted my kingdom, and he usurped it.
Bloody Terastor.
This is what Darendil looks like up close. Need a little blurb on him.
Well, you have been incredibly helpful in letting us know the order of things here. I mean, is there anything we can do, Your Highness, to, you know, facilitate this escape? You know, I'm sure we all, and I gestured to like everybody in the room, I'm sure we all would like to get home. So, you know, if you can think of anything, you know, any sort of plan, something that we could do to get away, and also on our part, if we think of anything, we will surely let you know.
He sits and thinks for a minute, and he says, "We have to get a message to my kingdom. If all is well, maybe they can send help.
They would have many warriors and so on.
Yes, yes.
Definitely come away.
They only have maybe a dozen or two dozen warriors here. We have an army in the thousands. They could come storm here and save their
own." I start laughing out loud. I mean, like, start laughing out loud.
But we took, it was a week travel from the service, so that would probably be a week and maybe half a week to get to where we are. So in the immediate future, we can think of something else. You know, that could be Plan B. Plan A is something we can think about, something else.
Well,
just in case this doesn't work.
Well, as the highest ranking person here, I hereby put you in charge of that. I mean,
kind of okay, thank you. Gracefully accept this honor, and I can't like that.
Are they still speaking in Elvish? Have they been speaking in Elvish the whole time?
I'm like cracking up behind his.
He's trying his best to just like turn like. Conspicuously turn his back to you and ignore you and just pretend like you're not there.
I am laughing. Like
he's shunning you like it's the worst thing in the world to like be shunned by him. Like
I mean, like before I was just trying to be polite, like, "Hey, dude, we know you're lying," but now I'm just laughing because it's just funny.
Prince Darendil, if I may ask you, do you have all the abilities of a Quaggoth, like their strength and?
Yes, and unfortunately, I'm stuck in this body, and he's kind of motions with his claws
I have these, and I have the body of a Quaggoth, but it's so ungainly and so ugly. Ugh, and you kind of give a shiver.
Have you ever tried breaking your chains?
Oh no, that's beneath me. That's not the role of a prince.
Well, I mean, you could break mine, and I can serve you.
He's such an idiot.
I don't show that, but I am surely the prince would do anything to help his subjects and keep his kingdom happy. You know?
Yes,
our friend here, Mr. Brill, has been trying unsuccessfully, as of yet, to break his chains, so maybe, you know, treating us as your subjects, you could maybe attempt to break his chains. They are already loosened by his attempt.
Yes, you're right. It's my duty as the prince to assist my subjects.
And if one of us can get free, then all of us can get free.
That's true.
We could send a message to your kingdom and come assist us.
Good job. Good plan. When we get free, I'll have boons and titles to bestow upon you.
Inspired by your great leadership.
I finally understand what's going on after making fun of the guy for so long. And I don't know if this is going to work, but if he does agree, I'm waiting for him to, like, agree for him to do it.
He
and, okay, I'm just going to, like, kind of touch him on the arm and say, you know, I apologize. That was really rude of me, and I want to cast guidance on him if I can.
What's
I don't know if I can.
Yeah.
It's a cantrip.
Click on the spell to like, just give me the description again, because I don't have all the spells memorized, sadly.
Spells, guidance!
One willing creature.
And I say, you know, I'm really sorry, but I think that, you know, I want to, I'll have faith in you to be able to do that, and I just want to cheer you on, and I cast guidance.
Okay. Well, he doesn't actually reply to you. Like, you get the sense he hasn't entirely forgiven you, but he does acknowledge you, and he kind of gives you a nod, which you get the sense is like the best of the prince's mercy that you're gonna get.
Okay.
It
took me a while to understand what was going on.
Yeah. So he tries to struggle against the chains. To really no effect. He, you know, kind of goes at this for a couple hours, just like Brill. He's kind of consumed by this. He tries his own, he tries Brill's, you know, all sorts of different combinations between the two, and it's kind of to no avail.
I walk over to Brill and say, I want to try something, because I don't know if this, and I kind of do one of these, like, he even cares. But I'm going to try to see if I can help you with your strength. And I want to try to cast guidance.
Okay.
On Brill.
When I see that she's casting something, I'll just be like...
Yeah, I don't know if it works yet, because I have no idea, because, like, the other guy was just try like, maybe that. A nod. And I'm just like...
I'm just like, you know, I'm just kind of like...
You kind of... You know, when you're casting, you kind of get the same feeling, like, when you're trying to polymorph. Like, you're... You're reaching out.
So I'm like really, really, really mad now.
You're trying to like reach for your connection to the nature around you, and it kind of feels like you're in a bubble or something. Like you're just coming up short. Like there's just nothing to reach.
I just shake my head and I look at Raven and I'm like, I can't do anything.
You remember being having kind of a similar feeling in like big cities like Waterdeep or Baldur's Gate or Neverwinter. When you're just in the middle of the city and there's no trees or anything around you, and you kind of feel the same kind of isolation that you're feeling now.
And I don't even have my little necklace.
But I think, Farron, you were saying something? Or was it Raven?
I was just, like, intently looking to see, because she was casting as well.
She was just casting and...
Yeah, it doesn't work. I'm like, yeah. I've tried that.
And Brill, you don't feel any stronger after she does her... Her ritual.
And I say, I swear.
It's not these, by the way, and I can change the chain. It's not these, by the way. Something elsewhere. Elusive.
Take two. Prison riot. I literally say that out loud.
We know that they're coming to get us in the morning. They're going to take us somewhere and give us tools to do something, either a sponge or a pickaxe. So maybe we could plan for then. If you see anything, try and hide it on your being, on yourself. You know, if you can find a bit of metal or something, that would be great.
Into my hair. It needs to be anyways.
I basically give up at this point and just lean back against this cave wall to go to sleep.
Alright, yeah. After struggling against it for a couple hours.
I'm resorting to...
The most disappointing part is you don't even seem to be making any progress. Like, you examine the parts of the chain that you've been struggling against, and it's not even chipped, it's not even worn or anything.
Yeah.
Whatever material it's made out of.
Slip my wrists out of the shackle.
You could. That would be a difficulty you'd be making. But it'd be the same kind of deal. This is what you're doing.
Breaking your thumb, to slip your hands out.
Yeah,
kind of thing.
It would be something in that vein, dislocating a finger or something to pop it out. But
Well, I have meaty fists, so it ain't happening for me.
Hey, all you gotta do
are they on pretty tight?
Slip them out.
The shackles are on pretty tight, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Even still, you break a thumb, you can get out.
That's just the way it works. It is a thing you can roll for, kind of in the way that you're rolling strength. If you prefer dexterity, basically.
But who wants to hurt themselves? I don't.
Would it be sleight of hand to try and wiggle it out?
Yes, I believe yes.
Oh. Wiggling is something interesting.
I believe it's sleight of hand.
Can I give that a try?
It would actually be just a dexterity. A modified dexterity.
Just a dexterity. Okay.
Yeah, you could give it a try. This would kind of be what you were doing while Brill and Darren Dillard.
I'll give it a try, and if it doesn't work.
If that so works, I'm still going to try the same thing. I might not succeed, but I would do it just because I'd be like, hey! I'm going to try.
Oh, nice.
20 what? Is actually what you needed.
Nice.
So right as you're about to give up, you make a little bit of progress. You feel like you kind of bend your thumb inward, and you kind of get your fingers as flat as they can, and you wiggle, and you're about to give up, and then you just get it past one of the knuckle on one of your early knuckles on your thumb, and then it's so easy from then on in. You manage to slip out one of your wrists. Your other wrist is still attached, but let's say your right hand. I'm assuming you're aiming for your right hand.
Do you say anything?
Oh, it's kind of like
not.
This is right at the end of your efforts, though. Some people are
just looking around, anybody see that? And if nobody saw me, I'll kind of nudge Brill in the shoulder.
Well, I'm sitting right next to you, so I would probably, if I didn't notice,
I'll just nudge you in the shoulder, hey.
Yeah.
Guess who's awesome? This guy. And I hold up my hand that's free, with my thumb. This guy. Problem is, I'm still half chained up. I mean, three quarters chained up because of my feet. But progress. Well,
good start.
You don't have your hand in there. I have an idea. You should try again.
Grab a hold of one of my cuffs with your freed hand, and I'll see if I can, and hold it steady. I'll see if I can pull my hand out.
Okay, I'll do that. Grab his cuff sort of thing.
I'm pathetic.
So this happens because you just barely got it with the 20, and it was a 20 DC. Yep. This happens right at the end of the night. So if you guys are going to continue trying, you're kind of burning sleeping time.
I wanted to talk real quick to Mr. Grumpy Face before I drift off.
Mr. Grumpy Face being the other drow?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
So I hobble back over there as they're doing whatever they're doing. And because I pretty much had enough with this fantasy prince. And I'm like, I'm just getting myself into trouble because I've been laughing. Then I was like, all right, well, if he's going to be nice, I'll try to be nice and I'll help. And then I felt sad because I couldn't help. So I'm like, all right, I'll help Brill. Felt sad I couldn't do that. So I was like, fine then. I'm just going to go over here and talk to this grumpy guy. So, and I ask him, I'm like, so I felt like we got on the wrong foot. We got off on the wrong foot.
As you approach, he just asks you, you again. What's the right foot to you?
I'm speaking in undercommon.
Yeah. He's replying in kind.
I'm like, I wasn't raised down here, I'm guessing. It's kind of dark. I'm assuming we're down. I feel like we ran into some cave or something, or I don't know.
He kind of gives you a slow nod and goes like, uh-huh.
Hey, you don't have to be mean, okay? Like, okay? All right. Now, I notice that all of these guards, they look like us. So, kind of...
You mean that they're drow?
Yes.
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 Correct.
So why would they put someone who is like them down here? They don't any kind of... I want to say heart.
To my knowledge, the rest of these prisoners were captured in raids. Were you captured in a raid?
I'm guessing. I just know one minute I was sleeping under a nice bell, and the next minute, See, okay, here's what happened. I took off my hood, right? And they kind of stopped. And I'm not knowing if they're going to stab me or whatever, and I get scared, and I kind of, like, do one of these things and to try to, like, get them away so I could run away. And, next thing I know, I'm here. So I guess... But what I don't understand is, like, okay, they stopped when they saw me, and I don't know what that means. And if they stopped while they saw me, then why are you down here? Because, like, I could see why they put me down here, because I fought back.
Yeah, fighting back will get you captured.
But I'd like to understand, because I'm kind of confused. What does that mean? Like, what did that... I don't understand.
Well, if you were on the surface, we drow don't usually live on the surface. I imagine they were just surprised to encounter one of our kind on the surface.
Have you ever been to the surface?
No.
It's very dark down here.
Yes.
I mean, sometimes the sunlight hurts my eyes, but... I know you know... It's all like, that's my business and not yours. But, like, you know, just wondering, like, why would they put you down here?
He kind of stays silent for a moment and says, I was part of the garrison, and there was a misunderstanding that'll be cleared up any minute now.
You worked with the guards?
Oh, yes. No, I'm one of them, yes. And I'm sure I'll go back to... Once I can clear my name, I'll be on the other end and be looking in at you. So don't bother trying to make friends.
Well, I wasn't trying to make friends, but I mean, after you've been treated like this, why would you go on treating other people like this? I'm sure you don't like it.
You're really, really not from around here.
No.
And then that's all he says to that.
So I kind of just Like, my attempt to get to know the only other drow that I've seen in my life has not been successful. So, I kind of say, well, enjoy your feces, and I go back this way. And I say to Raven, well, I was trying to chat up the guy over there.
You did catch his name in part of the pleasantries when you asked who he was. Said he was part of the guards. He said his name was Sereth.
Sereth. Oh, he's not going to like that. I'm so going to use that later
spelled
on.
How?
Sereth.
How that spelled?
Spelled how. S-A-R-I-T-H.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Sereth.
I actually am, as you're meeting these guys, I'm giving you journal entries for them also.
I noticed that.
Because some of the introductions, you guys aren't plumbing the full depths of their backstory just yet. Some of the stuff is kind of spoilery, which is kind of a shame. But I trust you guys to keep character knowledge and player knowledge separate.
Oh, of course.
Totally.
Yes.
Yeah, we don't meta game.
So I walk over to Raven, and I start talking to Raven, and then realizing, oh yeah, we have friends. So I kind of turn and face all three of them, and I'm
like, "You see that I'm one arm's out of a shackle, and I'm holding you."
Mm-hmm. So, I saw you wrote something about trying to get it back in.
I was contemplating putting it back in. I'm thinking should I put it back in? Because probably not gonna like that I got out of one.
We
in
make
the morning.
Girl is asleep at this point.
Okay, like it. I just put my hand back in so I didn't get beaten up tomorrow.
It's actually much harder to get it back in the way you got it to get it out.
That's okay, because now I have an idea. Anyways, so I kind of look at him and go, ooh, I said, can you try? I saw it, you were saying to me, I couldn't do the thing that I was doing. Does that mean that you can do those things too? I kind of do this thing with my hands.
I tried. Didn't work, but ooh. I looked at I don't think it's the shackles. So.
Are you sure? Can you try again now that your hand is free?
Yes, I will prestidigitation a puff of wind at Kyra.
You kind of at the end of the spell, you kind of flick your fingers out at her, expecting her hair to blow back or something, and just nothing.
Yeah. Oh, nothing. Okay. The signal was supposed to be a puff of wind, a firebolt or something.
No, nothing.
Okay. Nope.
Well, anyways,
I'm gonna get beaten up tomorrow.
Seeing that Brill is asleep, I try to keep my voice down even more than what I was doing already.
Brill kind of dips and grumbles. I am asleep.
Very tempted to stick my finger in my mouth and in his ear, just contemplating it. I'm an adult, but I am not acting like it. Okay, so I kind of say to Raven and Farron, I say, you see that drow over there? I've been kind of thinking... Yeah, that didn't work.
Oh, dear.
Did you hurt your hand as you try to stick it in there?
That was a one, wasn't it? You're just trying to wiggle and you're jamming it in and stuff, and you actually the hard part is getting your thumb to fold back in. You can get your other four fingers in up to your but just getting the thumb to slide in is a lot harder than getting it to slide out. As you're trying to get it in, and maybe in a little bit of frustration, try to force it a little too much, and you actually crack the nail on your thumb, and it really, really hurts.
That is the worst pain ever.
Yeah, right down the middle.
You could take some poop and slide it on your hand, and it probably would slide your hand out a lot easier.
I'm not doing that.
Oh, okay. I was thinking.
Especially with now that a little bit of blood is seeping out too through under the nail.
I'm bleeding out too.
It's not even 1 point of damage. It's just
yeah.
It just really hurts. And maybe smearing poop on the bloody wound isn't the best idea.
Yeah, and I look at Raven like, poop? Poop?
You can poop? No.
Poop? No. No? Oh, okay. No. Oh, it was a good idea, I thought.
I mean,
you got your hand out. I mean, it might make it easier. Just wondering, would that make it easier?
I'll cast tetanus shot.
Like, would poop make it easier to get your hand out? Would I know that? Like, is that something nature-wise that I would know that poop that's, like, nice and slick might actually help with the lubricant?
Yeah, like fresh poop, yes. Like, dried up poop would not help so much.
So, I do my best before I even finish. I was talking about something, but I'm trying to convince them that poop is the best way to get the rest of our shackles off. Just saying. Anyway, well, and then after...
I'm guessing it's like shackle, because you said it's shackle, chain, shackle. I'm going to wrap the chain that's between the other two shackles like around my wrist,
mm-hmm.
and then grab the other side with my hands. I'm like holding them together like that, but the chain's around my wrist, so if you're not looking too closely, you'd be like, oh, yeah, he's still chained up.
Sure, sure.
And I'm going to, like, hold that, like, under myself so that if in the morning when they come to get us, they're not just like, hey, you're out of your chains.
Right, right.
You know. So I'm just going to, like, Ugh. And so, if they do look, I'll be like, I have my thumb.
I tell them about the drow guard, like, saying that, like, you know, he doesn't belong here. His name is Sarath. And I'm thinking maybe we could use that to our advantage. He says that he doesn't make friends, but he obviously did something to get thrown down here. So I'm thinking if, you know, we get in trouble, maybe we're like, hey, well, Sarath said it was okay kind of thing. Like, that's what I'm thinking. Just saying. Kind of throwing that out to everybody. You know, Brill's asleep, but throwing it out to both of them.
Like, throw him under the carriage or something?
No, like he said it was okay. Like, you know, he's our, you know, whatever. I don't know. I will make up some BS if I have to. But literally, I'm thinking, hey, you're good talking. You've been talking this whole time. So just kind of, like, throwing it your way. Like, well, maybe you can make it work. Especially since your hand is all out, and if you get caught...
If he's here, and, you know, they're drow and they kidnapped us, I'm guessing it's probably, like, the most humiliating place they could put him, you know, apart from killing him outright. You know, let's make him
a slave. I'm not sure. He said it was a misunderstanding. He said as soon as it gets sorted out, they're going to come for him. So my thing is, if they're going to come for him... then that means that they have keys. And they will be unlocking him. I say...
I'm going to get some sleep now because my thumb's really sore.
Yeah, the sort of fishy meditation noises that have been going on this entire time, just totally evenly nonstop, have gone from, like, kind of annoying and funny to, like, weirdly relaxing in how, like, totally... evenly spaced and
rhythmic. Is it sort of like there's like the fishy relaxing noise and then there's like a coming
coming
from Brill for sure.
Several people are asleep at this point. Most of the people in the cave are asleep, except for you guys really.
Like, I suggest we probably get some sleep. It seems like we'll be doing a bit of work tomorrow and we have been walking for a week.
I don't sleep.
Well, do what you do.
I don't sleep.
Wake me in the morning when somebody comes in so I can make sure that they don't see that I'm unchained.
I just
lie down and go to sleep.
Go over towards Raven and I'm like, we have got to get out of here. And I've thought of everything I could and I can't think of anything else. So if you can think of anything, just let me know.
There really isn't any kind of way to pick a lock from this side.
No.
We're going to need to get out of our chains to start with.
Right, and that's why I was thinking, he said, going on what he's saying, that they're going to come and get him out of here when they sort it out. Somebody has to have a key. I don't see them escorting him in chains. I see them unlocking them him. So somebody's going to have a key.
Somebody's going to have a key. I think we help everybody out of chains. We just plan an ambush when they come in to get us.
That's what I'm thinking. And maybe, you know, Charisma Boy can, like, you know, rally the troops or something. Talk some people into it. And we're going to need some help. It's just four of us. But, you know, they're not going to have as many guards because they're thinking we're in chains. We can't do anything. So if we can get everybody to agree to it, you know, maybe we can do something.
Right.
And then I just go over to next to Raven and say, I'm tired. And I just lay down on his lap because I don't want to get my hair dirty in the poop. So that's what I do. I don't even ask. I just lay down.
I fold her hair up in my lap.
So everyone's gone to bed?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to bed.
The elves who need less sleep wake up first, and they're kind of have a couple hours of wakefulness. Everyone else is kind of awoken, or immediately after you awake, you hear "clear the room" from outside the bars. And
making sure that my hands are like wrapped up, so it looks like I'm wearing this chain again.
And in fact, you see kind of the people nearest the door kind of scooch a little bit away, and through the door, six Quaggoths kind of form. I guess you can actually even fit six. They form kind of a wall, and you know, have their claws and teeth bared and are ready to.
Thanks.
Attack, and flanked by the spacing isn't working out the way I'd like it to, but
yeah.
What do we know about this?
Flanked by two warriors is a female drow holding a whip, just very let me actually give you guys a good close up on her.
Right? She wearing leather?
she's wearing like robes.
Okay.
Or like a
stilettos.
Something like that. This is what she looks like.
Okay.
She's very clearly the one in charge. Kind of has that nice bearing, and addresses the room in general. I know we have some new guests today. I will tell you what I've told everyone else. Accept your fate, learn to obey, and you might yet survive. And it's just turns around. I'm going to call the session right there at that. If that's all right with everyone?
Yeah. And I can keep going, but that's fine.
I have to go pick up my partner.
Yeah, that's fine.
And also, I think the sleep is like finally catching up to me. Hopefully it wasn't too obvious in the session.
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Did everyone have a pretty good time, hopefully?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, freaking awesome. It was a great session. Perfect introduction.
I gotta think about how to get out of this place.
Yeah, I thought we had it.
Yep. No, we can't do anything, like, even verbal or somatic kind of things, like, we're
kind of here. I mean, if you're feeling kind of helpless, that's very much intentional.
That's the point.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. That's so unequipped for this.
Yeah.
On side of some decent skill checks.
Yep.
Oh, well, at least I have an arm out.
Yeah, you have an arm out.
Yay! I'm going to friggin' start a prison riot. That's the only thing I was going to say. Throw the poop!
I mean, like, this is the kind of the scene we're going to be picking up on when we start again in a week. Is in a week time good for everyone?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Weekly is the best.
So, I mean, next week at around the same time, maybe, this is what you guys are going to be greeted with. So if you want to throw a poop, now's not a terrible time, assuming you're not afraid of Quaggoth.
I was going to ask, but I'll ask next time, like, you know, do we know anything about that or whatever?
I mean,
Quaggoths They're a bit like trolls from Skyrim, aren't they?
Yeah, something like that. I can like pull up their thing too. Actually,
I was thinking that maybe Farron might have been like, seen those.
Farron knows what they are, so I'll actually pull up the entry here. So, like, whenever I do this for just a generic creature, this is pretty much the monster manual entry, straight out of it. So, like, all the text is kind of what you would see if you were to open up the monster manual. And that should kind of give you an idea of, like, what a learned person might, like, book learn about a creature or a species.
Yeah. Wanna make them angry?
But I've got to go. I had a blast doing this. Hopefully you guys did too.
Yes.
I'll see you guys next week.
Have a great week, Martin.
Have a good week.
Take care, Martin.
Bye bye.
See ya.
Well, how was that for episode 1? We had a ton of fun playing this game, and I'm really blessed. We have a fantastic DM, and I'm playing with 3 other amazing players, and the characters are all really interesting too. I think this group is actually going to really mesh nicely, which will be a lot of fun to see how that develops. So hopefully you had a good time listening, and we had a ton of fun playing it. We will be playing this weekly on Monday nights, and I will get the videos posted as regularly as possible, once a week, and I will get to a point where we actually have a weekly schedule with just this video. For now, I'll get them out as fast as I can, of course, and I appreciate you stopping by and give us a chance to entertain you. Please like, subscribe, and stay tuned for the next videos coming out real soon. Of course, I hope to see you at the table, or like we've been playing, the virtual table, and as always, please, hey, keep rolling 20s.